Hello. Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to welcome everyone to the annual Economic and Revenue Consensus Forecasting Conference. This is the first consensus forecast conference that we're doing virtually. My name is Robert Mujica, Director of the Budget for the State of New York. And joining me today in the Joint Revenue Forecasting panel are Senator Liz Krueger, Chair of the Senate Finance Committee, Assemblywoman Helene Weinstein, Chair of the Assembly Ways and Means Committee, Senator Tom O'Mara, Ranking Member of the Senate Finance Committee, and Assemblyman Ed Rah, Ranking Member of the Assembly Ways and Means Committee, and Maria Dulles, Deputy Comptroller. I'd like to thank our presenters, Chris Varvaris, Vice President and Co-Head of the U.S. Economics IHS Market, Hugh Johnson, Chairman of the and Chief Investment Officer of Hugh Johnson Advisors, LLC, Jason Brem, Research Officer for the Federal Reserve Bank of New York, and Kajal Lahiri, Distinguished Professor of Economics and Health Policy at the University of Albany, at the State University of New York, and Jared Walczak, Vice President of State Projects at the Tax Foundation. Today's conference is being done virtually in response to the pandemic and represents the first steps in what we hope will be a smooth process towards the 11th consecutive balanced on-time budget during these unprecedented times for the state, the nation, and the world. Each member of this panel will have an opportunity to present brief opening remarks. Afterwards, we'll hear testimony from a cross-section of experts who will offer their perspectives on the current economic and revenue situation. After 10 years of responsibly managing our finances, the state, under Governor Cuomo's leadership and in partnership with the legislature, enjoyed its longest period of economic expansion in history. During this expansion, 1.3 million private sector jobs were added, reaching a record high employment of 8.4 million. Debt was at the lowest levels since the 1960s, and we achieved our highest credit ratings since the 1970s. When we met last year, revenue for the upcoming fiscal year was expected to grow 6.7%. When the pandemic and the resulting economic upheaval arrived in March, with no warning or protection, Governor Cuomo stabilized New York's finances, hiring, new contracts, and all wage increases were frozen. Historic levels of unemployment insurance, about $65 billion, was delivered to more than 4 million New Yorkers. New programs to nourish the hungry, so support small businesses, and assist our tenants have been funded during the ensuing pandemic. And our nearly empty transit system kept moving to ensure that essential workers could get to work while the rest of the state was in lockdown. In April of last year, we projected $63 billion four-year revenue loss. At its peak, over 2 million New Yorkers lost their jobs, and the virus spread was continuing to peak. But in the third quarter of 2020, the economy recovered faster than our expectations. While the economic improvement is beneficial, it is not enough to offset the dramatic revenue loss, and we remain down $33 billion over 4 years, including losses of $9.9 billion in 2021 and $8.2 billion in 2022. We still face a $15 billion gap to maintain current services, and as Governor Cuomo has repeatedly advocated, the federal government must deliver the $15 billion we need so that New York State can afford even baseline investments and funding of essential services. New York's economic recovery is critical for the recovery of the nation. New York State produces 8% of U.S. gross domestic product. If we are hobbled by federal inaction, so too are our fellow Americans. So let's not forget, New York already sends more than $23 billion more to Washington than we receive annually in return. This was made worse by the imposition of the cap on state and local taxes, or SALT, that was part of the federal tax plan announced enacted in 2017, which raised taxes on New Yorkers by over $30 billion over 3 years. This was the nation's first double tax in history, requiring New Yorkers to pay taxes on the taxes that they pay. Governor Cuomo will continue to fight to protect New Yorkers and repeal the salt cap, and for the federal funding we need to ensure that essential services are provided so that our economy can grow out of this pandemic. The state and national economy is likely to be affected by the COVID-19 pandemic for years to come. While real GDP is currently expected to return to its pre-COVID levels by the end of 2021, employment for both the nation and the state is not expected to return to pre-pandemic levels until 2023 or 2024. Our economic and revenue outlook is premised on the continuation of the present recovery, with vaccinations as well as overall containment efforts allowing businesses and consumers to safely return to pre-pandemic levels of economic activity. However, despite the positive tax receipt trends we have all witnessed since the enactments of last year's budget, the risks to our current revenue outlook are unprecedented. We are still below last year's revenue levels, even with our most recent 30-day amendment revisions. Additional virus waves spurred by new strains put the recovery in jeopardy and could lead to rapid declines in tax receipts. A key risk, not just for tax receipts, but for the overall health of our state economy and our ability to fund key investments, is the current trend of net out-migration, particularly of high-income individuals. Thanks to the governor's fiscal discipline that kept average annual spending growth to 2% prior to the pandemic, we've been able to lower income taxes for the middle class. This in turn has led to a more progressive tax structure where the state's highest earners carry a growing share of tax liability. The top 2% of resident filers today, about 188,000 New Yorkers, pay more than 50% of all of the state's personal income taxes. And today, the top earners in New York pay a larger share of state income taxes than they did 10 years ago. With the onset of COVID, we saw New Yorkers leaving New York City and the state to all parts of the country, with concentrations from the Upper West Side and Upper East Sides, where the highest earner lives, showing the most movement. We need to be focused on how we bring them back. We are, of course, already contending with the cap on salt deductions, and there's anecdotal evidence that it was already accelerating out-migration prior to COVID. There's another reason that we need unrestricted federal funding. New York has already carried the heaviest burden of COVID in the country after the federal government failed to protect us, and we shouldn't have to carry it further by risking our ability to compete against other states. We need to be especially mindful that as we navigate the consensus process, we ensure that New Yorkers are returned to New York and return to work. Therefore, I'm particularly interested in hearing the assessment of our expert panel on the following. What is your assessment of the current US and state economic trends, and what are the key risks to your forecast? Also, what in your estimation should New York do to maintain its competitive economic advantage and speedily return to sustained growth across all industries? My hope is that our panel of experts we'll be able to comment on these risks and others that we haven't thought of yet. Once again, we embark on the revenue consensus process as a backdrop of unprecedented disruption to lives, first and foremost, and to our economy. The types of actions proposed in the executive budget on both the revenue and spending sides are responsible and necessary to strengthen New York's fiscal position. For 10 years, we have all worked together to enact timely, fiscally responsible budgets that have positioned us to support us against the pandemic. And we embrace the principle that state spending must grow more slowly than the overall economy. By controlling and managing spending growth, we have reduced the need to engage in overly aggressive revenue projections, and that has served us well. All parties deserve credit for the responsible budget making. Each of the forecasts before us today represents a good faith contribution to the consensus process. I know that we are all committed to meeting the statutory March 1st deadline for a consensus revenue agreement, and revenue consensus is a truly important component of achieving our shared goal of a timely and responsible enacted budget. So at this point, I'd like to offer the other members of this panel an opportunity to make their opening remarks, and we'll begin with the chair of the Senate Finance Committee, Senator Liz Krueger.
Thank you, Rob. Well, it's nice to see everyone looking healthy and safe about a year later when we last had our revenue consensus forecasting meeting. And I know I will never forget that at the last minute of everyone finishing their prepared remarks, they brought up the fact that it appeared that because of changes in health risk and the economy over just the last few days, I believe it was just the last few days, that none of you were sure anything you had told us would actually be the case. And it could be much, much, much worse. And I think what we've learned in 12 months, you were right, it did get much, much, much worse. And Rob went over a lot of the, you know, substance of the details. Again, I'll just start with a reinforcement of the fact that there have been 500,000 Americans who died from this COVID-19 death so far. And while we feel like we're getting our arms around handling it, more will die. And we don't know what it means to see the COVID disease itself morphing in different parts of the world, and whether that will blow up our efforts with vaccines. I feel that it won't, but it doesn't mean that we aren't going to be dealing with this in ways we haven't even thought through for a continually long period of time. We also learned in the last year that when it comes to the social and economic and healthcare fallouts of pandemics such as this, that those of us who have the least resources are the worst hit. And so we have seen that the disproportionate impact on communities of color, on low-income people, on people who have less access to healthcare has been beyond tragic. And I believe that it sends a message to us in government of where we need to be focusing and prioritizing our rebuilding and thinking through what in this new world order requires of us. Because of the strength of the US and the New York State recoveries, as Rob just went into, we will continue to depend on a trajectory of the pandemic for quite some time, but the economic and revenue outlooks remain highly uncertain, but that there's optimism in the relatively newest figures. Despite all of these uncertainties, there's some encouraging recent developments for us here in New York that potentially substantially decrease our risks for the next year. The first, obviously, is the rollout of the vaccines, which will help reduce the number of COVID-19 cases and will increase the possibilities that our economy can start to go back to normal. The second, which is also huge for us here in New York State, given, again, as was described, the strange formulas where Washington takes more of our money than we get back, even when we really need it, is the fact that we changed our Washington, D.C. administration just over a month ago. And with the new administration, including the White House and a new Congress, we have dramatically improved the prospects that we will continue to see the amount of fiscal support at the state and local level that we know we need and the governor has been crying out for. We're not allowed to count that money because it hasn't passed in a final bill, but I personally believe when you have the head of the US Senate, who is of course a New York State Senator Chuck Schumer, and the head of the House of Representatives, Nancy Pelosi, calling us and assuring us of amounts of money that we're going to be getting over the next 2 years, and that it meets the requirements that we have set out for Washington. I know that that certainly helps me go to sleep at night. So I look forward to hearing your testimony and getting a better understanding of what we need to think about, what we need to project for receipts being forecast, so that we can, in tandem with our colleagues in the Assembly and the Governor's Chamber, make the best budget decisions possible, where I guess we've all learned what you think you might know might not really be the same story if you just wait any amount of time. That's perhaps the lesson for all of us, that be sure, but you can't be totally sure. So thank you, Rob, for putting us all together today.
Thank you, Senator Krueger. Now we'll go to Assemblywoman Weinstein, Chair of the Assembly Ways and Means Committee.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I'm pleased to be here today to join with all of you in this strange world that we're in today. So obviously with my colleague and with the budget director, I look forward to hearing the panelists' thoughts on the economic outlook for both the state and the nation, with a particular focus on your views about the outlook, obviously, for New York State's economy and the risks and uncertainties we face going forward. And as has been said, over the past year, the state's economy has seen its share of difficulties related to COVID-19 pandemic, punctuated by the record-breaking losses of the second quarter. And so far, the recovery has been slow and uneven, and obviously the future is filled with uncertainties. So I'm, along with the other issues that were raised by the budget director, particularly interested in hearing your outlook for the national and state economies, both in the short term and long term as the economic recovery continues. And this analysis is very important to us every year. As we look to evaluate the current economic conditions and to respond as effectively as possible. And I would add one other issue that I like people to address, or we can talk about it afterwards, and that's a question of economic inequality. So I think it's no secret that high income earners have benefited disproportionately from the COVID recovery, while a large number of low-wage workers remain unemployed. And curious what impact you think the uneven recovery will have on our state's economy. And do you believe that the increased income inequality will be a temporary situation, or will it remain elevated in the post-COVID economy? And your independent viewpoints, along with today's discussion, help to provide a solid foundation as we debate various aspects of the budget in this year of uncertainties. And again, I thank you for being here, and I don't want to take up any more time because I really want to hear, look forward to and hear your comments today. So.
Thank you, Assemblymember. Now we'll go to Senator Tom O'Mara, Ranker in the Senate Finance Committee.
Thank you, Robert. Good afternoon to my fellow legislative colleagues, Deputy Comptroller, and most importantly, welcome and thank you to our panel of economic experts to help us on our annual conference on the economy, the projected revenue trends of the state, and outlook for the nation. I look forward to hearing your analysis, as this information will help guide us and the fiscal committees of the state legislature as we move forward to enact the final budget for the state of New York, which we certainly hope to reach on time and a balanced budget. We believe that the revenues are coming in stronger than were initially projected by the Division of Budget, especially most recently with increases in personal income tax receipts. Based on several of these factors, the Republican Conference of the Senate is projecting that revenue for fiscal year 2021 will be $1.6 billion higher than the amended financial plan submitted by DOB, and about $1 billion higher for fiscal year 2022, with a two-year estimate from our Republican Conference in the Senate of $2.6 billion higher than the amended financial plan. I also believe that our discussion needs to be taken in light of the likelihood of a significant federal relief package that's on the table and being discussed, and certainly taking into account our strong tax receipts and this federal aid that's expected. It seems clear that increases, tax increases, should be rejected at this time. As was mentioned, the concerns over out-migration, many of the taxes that are being proposed will hit the hardest on our high-income, most mobile population, and significantly impact the financial services industry, which is the largest factor in the overall state budget. And I think the last thing we need to do is be giving more reasons for individuals or businesses in the financial services sector to leave New York, as we have seen some do in recent years. But having said that, I look forward to our discussion and look forward to the information we're going to receive from our panelists here today to help us reach that consensus. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator. And now we'll go to Assemblyman Ed Rah, ranking member of the Ways and Means Committee.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Budget Director. Thank you to my colleagues and our panelists for being here. We were talking before we started about how much obviously has changed since last year, and it was really within weeks after we had this hearing and worked toward consensus and talking about, where the revenues would be above what the financial plan looked like. We had them completely just plummet to depths we hadn't really seen before. And myself and my predecessors in this position have for many years talked about how difficult it is to predict taxpayer behavior, especially laws change at the state and local, at the state and federal level, and taxpayers are going to act in ways that may help them reduce their tax liability. And certainly the last year has driven home that point as we have gotten used to remote working. We're doing this hearing remotely for the first time, as we've done with all our budget hearings, and people are really working in a different way. And that has shown that for many businesses, they've been able to continue to function in that manner. And it really creates a concern as we talk about our economy, as we talk about really our tax climate, that people may be more capable of relocating than ever before, while still, maintaining their income to more friendly climates. As we know, there are many organizations that have ranked our tax climate negatively, and we've seen much out-migration over the years. But as we get into this budget process, there was a lot of talk about all kinds of different tax proposals that will increase taxes on individuals, on businesses, on certain transactions. And I think we need to keep that in mind. And I'm certainly interested in the panelists' thoughts on that. But I think as we emerge from the COVID crisis, we need to obviously encourage our businesses and individuals to stay within New York State. We need to show that it is a place that is open for business and will help with that economic recovery that we need to have. I think we're starting to see some receipts heading in the right direction, which is a positive sign. But as we said last year and every year, we never know exactly what the future holds. So I'm very interested in the panelists and analysis on the federal and state economies, and certainly any insight they can share on what the best way for New York to move forward is. So thank you for being here as we work with our colleagues to try to reach a revenue consensus.
Thank you, Assemblyman. Maria Doulas, from Deputy Comptroller, New York State Comptroller's Office.
Hi, thank you all. I'm here on behalf of Comptroller Thomas DiNapoli. And on behalf of the Comptroller and myself, I want to thank all for participating today in what is an important part of the process for enacting a budget that is timely. My remarks are very brief and they really focus on the need for caution. Forecasting the state's tax revenues is challenging in any year, but the unprecedented nature of the public health and economic crises call for particular caution. As Comptroller DiNapoli noted in his preliminary executive budget analysis, the outlook for state revenues has improved. Year-to-date tax receipts have outperformed enacted budget forecasts, and the amended executive budget financial plan has increased projected tax receipts by $1.6 billion annually. However, there continue to be significant risks in the revenue forecast, including the ongoing public health challenges of managing COVID-19, the unknown shape of the economic recovery, and the final scope and the form of federal aid, which is being negotiated as we speak. Forecasting amid such uncertainty requires careful consideration of the latest economic data. With personal income taxes representing nearly two-thirds of the state's tax receipts, particular focus should be paid to assessing the components of personal income growth and the expected performance of the financial services sector over the coming year. The devastating impacts of the pandemic have demonstrated how quickly and drastically the state's fiscal circumstances can change. And as you work to reach consensus, caution should be a guiding principle in the process. Thank you, and I look forward to hearing from our experts today.
Thank you, Maria. Okay, so with that, we will now go to our presenters, and hopefully they can enlighten us with some of their perspectives and also address some of the questions that the panelists have raised. We'll start with Chris Varvaris from IHS. Market. Chris?
thank you very much. Let me get my screen shared here.
Chris, do you want us to move on and go back to you?
Well, let me just, it'll take 1 second.
Sure,
just
to, no problem.
The script okay. Shared. All of a sudden, it was there a moment ago, and then you shrank. Here we go. There we are. Okay, apologies. You should be seeing the PowerPoint presentation now. How about now?
Yep, now okay. We see it.
Great. Thank so you. Apologies for the delay there. So obviously the economic outlook has changed rather dramatically over the past year. And I think we were right at the end of the session last year to caution that things would turn out dramatically worse. And it was over the next few weeks after the meeting last year that we really came to grips with just how bad this was going to be. It really took us into sort of mid second, third week of March before we I think really realized we were standing on the edge of the abyss and looking down a very deep hole with very little idea of how deep that hole was. So now we're on the backside. And as we've said all along, the pandemic is the boss. It will determine how we proceed over the next several quarters and years. And I think it has been said already, and I wanna emphasize the point that the COVID-19 will be with us for some time. And that of course casts a pall over the economic outlook that we have to be aware of and constitutes the greatest downside risk to all of our outlooks. In the upper left, we know that the lockdowns early on were the primary reason that the economy fell into a deep hole. As we opened up, the economy rebounded nicely, very strong growth in the third quarter. But then as cases rose again and containment measures were reimposed, the growth rate slowed dramatically from the third quarter to the fourth quarter and indeed into the first quarter of 2021. Now, last year we had things going in opposite directions. Cases were rising, containment measures were rising, and that pulled down consumer spending. Stimulus was going in the opposite direction and supporting consumer spending. This year, everything is sort of pulling in the same direction. So cases are falling, containment measures are falling, and stimulus is coming on board very, very large. So from the end of last year to this year, we're adding really $3 trillion of new federal stimulus. That's assuming that the $1.9 trillion bill gets through reconciliation, which is a pretty good bet. So with that stimulus, we see a very strong outlook this year. Measured year over year, 5.7% growth of GDP. Measured fourth over fourth is shown on the table, 6.1% growth of GDP. How does that compare to some other notable forecasters? The blue chip consensus, as you've probably seen, is at 4.9%. A lot of folks there have not fully implemented the impact of stimulus, so that number will probably rise again next month. Goldman Sachs is at 7 compared to our 5.7. Morgan Stanley is at 7.6. So we feel like there's a considerable upside risk to this forecast as stimulus comes in, and I'll mention one other possibility that could add to more, more upside. So what are the downside risks? Undoubtedly, that it's that COVID-19 proves more resilient than spending. Very, very disheartening is the fact that the AstraZeneca and the Pfizer vaccines appear to be very ineffective against the South African strain. Johnson & Johnson, somewhat more effective. But imagine all the people who've already gotten the Pfizer vaccine suddenly have to be revaccinated, or the vaccine has to be reformulated. That will delay the full effectiveness of those vaccines, will allow the virus to continue to spread and mutate. And so it is not a slam dunk that we will be back to normal this fall, although that is our operative assumption. Continuing cash flows on the part of businesses could push some over the edge into insolvency and ultimately bankruptcy. Now, we do expect something of a consumer spending binge. I'll talk about it in a second. And we do expect some firming in inflation. And some are concerned that we might even have an inflation spike that the Fed will have to respond to. So we'll address those risks momentarily. So looking at this potential for a spending move. So we know that the saving rate last year spiked up into in the monthly data here, as is shown on the left-hand chart, over 30% as the checks hit in April, March and April last year. And gradually the saving rate fell. The dotted line shows what it would have been had it stayed at its pre-pandemic level. The right-hand chart shows that in terms of dollars, how much incremental saving occurred over the months of last year, and how did that accumulate? Well, it accumulated to about $1.6, $1.7 trillion of excess savings. And the question is, will this powder keg of cash prove irresistible to consumers as they get back to normal and power a huge, huge increase in spending? Some people, notably very famous economists, Olivier Blanchard and Larry Summers as well, have thought that this will be unleashed and it will cause the saving rate to plunge. According to their narrative, it would drive the saving rate, as you can see in the lower right-hand chart, this goes all the way back to the Depression, would drive the saving rate temporarily 5 percentage points below the pre-pandemic level shown in the horizontal line. Well, it didn't happen in the aftermath of World War II, and we don't think it's going to happen today. We think consumers will continue to act appropriately. They will view that one-time surge in income as an increment to their wealth and will spend it out gradually over time. Now, we do consider other scenarios. Lower right-hand chart shows, yes, we could have much stronger consumer spending pushing up near 8 to 9% versus 6% in our base forecast this year. And that, of course, would be a sort of welcome additional kick to the economy. The labor market will continue to improve, although the pace of improvement already has slowed dramatically from what we saw last year. A couple of key questions here are how many jobs have been lost permanently. We saw in the lower left-hand chart in the Great Recession that those so-called permanent job losses took a very long time to come back. We haven't seen quite the same number of permanent losses, but a concern here is that because of structural changes, primarily in travel, leisure, entertainment, that many of those lost jobs will be a long time coming back. Business travel will not be what it was before. Even personal travel will not be what it was before. What about the return of workers? Well, we know something like 3 to 4 million workers dropped out of the labor force because the lousy job market, because the need to stay home and care for their children who were not in school or not in daycare. The upper right-hand chart shows our projection of a gradual return of the overall labor force back to its pre-pandemic trend. We might get lucky. We might, people might come back sooner, and jobs may return sooner. Obviously, that's a good upside. I think the real downside in the labor market is the possibility of scarring, that people who've been out for a long time will not get back in. They'll be long-term unemployed, providing additional burdens on social programs, and not there as a source of tax revenue. Can the unemployment rate fall as quickly as we are projecting? It doesn't look very quick in the upper left-hand chart, but look in the lower right-hand chart. Compared to prior recessions, after that initial sharp decline, it still declines fairly quickly. And the only other time we've seen it decline that quickly was back after the 81-82 recession, where we did see growth rates that were 6, 7, 8, 9%, somewhat stronger, but close to what we're currently assuming. So it's possible that we'll see big declines like that as we're forecasting. It's possible. People are somewhat concerned that with this much stimulus and pushing the unemployment rate, I'm sorry, and I should note that in our forecast, we do see the unemployment rate in 2024 getting to about 3.5%. So that's a little bit, that's about where we were at the last cycle, maybe a touch below. Okay, people are concerned that with this much stimulus and rapid growth underway, and with the sharp upturn in commodity prices that we've seen, that we will see a surge in inflation, and that inflation will end up being somehow the cause of a short-circuiting a full recovery. We don't see it that way. The global economy has proved itself to be very inflation-proof, not susceptible to inflation the last decade or so. And our expectation is that we'll see enough slack in the economy, both in labor and product markets, that inflation will be slow to come back. Key among the assumptions here is that just the inflation generating process is such that even when we get to an unemployment rate of 3.5%, while yes, it might contribute a little bit to rising inflation, we don't see it contributing very much, the so-called flat Phillips curve, if you will. Most importantly, we think that long-term inflation expectations will remain well anchored around the Fed's 2% inflation target. And when that happens, it's very difficult for inflation to deviate much either to the upside or the downside. That was a very important factor in preventing inflation from falling more than it did in the last recession, in the Great Recession, and we think it'll be important in limiting inflation on the upside. However, we did do, and I should note that when we added the stimulus to this forecast, inflation did want to move up a little bit more. And as a result, we moved forward in time our expectation of when the Fed would tighten. That, of course, in the forecast generated rising interest rates, not unlike we are seeing recently. And that rise in interest rates does take a little bit of the heat off the economy and prevent inflation from moving higher. So the economy does have these sort of self-equilibrating processes that we think will help to keep inflation in check. However, we can't rule out a much higher inflation path as a, quote, risk to our base forecast. If you look in the right-hand chart, if inflation expectations became unmoored, and if the Fed did not tighten in mid-2024, as we assume, we could see inflation rising fairly quickly to 2.5% instead of barely edging up to 2% as in our base forecast. My question is, well, what would be so bad about that? Okay, the Fed wants inflation to be a little higher. I think our expectation is the Fed would be a little uncomfortable with inflation over 2.5%, but under the right circumstances, they might tolerate it. So that's a risk of sorts to the forecast. From the revenue generating perspective, it's not necessarily a bad risk to have somewhat higher inflation over the short run. All right, so we do have interest rates rising. We have the Fed tightening in mid-2024. Term treasury yields we have increasing. Already they've gotten to about levels that we anticipated as of the third quarter of this year. We have them ending around the 10-year treasury entering around 145 or so at the end of this year. So obviously they've moved a little bit more quickly than we anticipated. And that move is in part a response to a rising term premium, but also in response to the markets coming around to the view that the Fed will be tightening perhaps sooner than they had previously anticipated. Corporate spreads will continue to narrow. In terms of another risk to the economy, this increase in rates obviously is part of the negative feedback mechanism. When the economy proves strong, interest rates rise. At the margin, that tends to slow demand and growth. In addition, it puts upward pressure on the dollar. So we did raise our forecast of the Fed's trade-weighted exchange rate. And that tends to disadvantage exports and advantage imports. And it saps some of the growth of domestic demand away from GDP. And so that is an additional factor that is sort of keeping growth reasonable and sustainable, or at least at a reasonable level over the second half of this year. In terms of the fiscal stimulus, federal current expenditures, assuming that we end up spending about $1.5 trillion of that $1.9 trillion this year, we can see the bump up over the first half of 2021. We probably have that a little bit front loaded, although that does primarily include expenditures on vaccines and transfers to state and local governments to facilitate an accelerated pace of vaccinations and replace and buy PPE, et cetera. In terms of its impact on consumers, the upper right-hand chart shows in a little monthly model of consumer expenditures what the impact is of both the added unemployment benefits, which of course that's just replacing income that's otherwise lost, so net, it's maybe not doing very much. And then the stimulus checks are the brown bar additions. In the lower right-hand side, we see this is government consumption and gross investment, both federal and state and local. And it does provide a pretty good boost to growth, which gets us to have GDP growth over the second half of this year in the 5% to 7% range. It'd be the fastest since the early to mid 1980s. However, there is a little bit of a payback after that initial spending. The level falls a little bit, so the growth rate of spending turns negative, and that means a little bit of drag on the backside. When we look at in terms of some of the overall numbers, let me go to here's the quarterly growth rate for GDP. We're looking at a very solid, we've revised our Q1 number down to about 4% from 4.7. Turns out that's quite a bit below what some of the Federal Reserve Bank nowcasts are averaging, close to 10%. We think that's crazy high. Those forecasts do not involve the kinds of judgmental adjustments that we make. They're kind of mechanical. But a 4% growth rate in the first quarter with very strong growth throughout the rest of the year. So that's good, with some upside, as I indicated earlier, especially when you look at some of the forecasters' numbers. One other thing in terms of the risks for New York State, I think the increase in the federal minimum wage to 15, given that you guys have already moved, would actually be a positive. It would increase the competitiveness of New York vis-a-vis other states. So perhaps that's one small positive. And some of the other changes with respect to tax policy, SALT, and so forth, potentially also beneficial to New York. But I think really the key is going to be the roughly $350 billion when you look at the two components, the direct state and local grants and the vaccine money that's in this currently in the bill, combines for about $350 billion. I think New York State will get its fair share there, and that will help to fill in largely, if not more than fill in the budget hole that you're looking at. And there I'll stop.
Thank you, Chris. Next, we'll go to questions after we hear from all of the presenters. So we'll save the questions for then. Hugh Johnson, we'll go to you if you're ready.
Yeah, I am. Go ahead.
Okay, great.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Budget Director, all the members of the panel from the Senate and the Assembly. I very much appreciate you having me come and share with you some of my thoughts. It's on what I see ahead for the U.S. economy, and I'll spend a little bit of time on the New York State economy, maybe a little more detail than Chris just gave you. Chris, it's very hard to really, quite frankly, Chris had a lot of things to say and a lot of detail, a lot of numbers for you to look at. Having looked at these numbers, not the ones that Chris presented, but having looked at numbers as much as I ordinarily do, I would say it's an extremely there's nothing extreme. It's a very sensible forecast. And if I were among you trying to put together to organize a forecast for the New York State or for the national economy, I certainly would pay attention to what Chris's forecast says. You know, one of the things, as Chairperson Weinstein knows, I do occasionally, is I try to come up with a song which I think characterizes or summarizes what I think is going on in this world of ours. Last year at this time, it was, I don't know if you remember, the Everly Brothers and Problems, Problems, Problems All Day Long. Some of you are too young to know who the Everly Brothers are or were, and probably don't remember that song, but it was certainly appropriate at the time. And then there was March 23rd when the stock market turned, and I came up with the song, What a Difference a Day Makes. That was a Dinah Washington song. And then the song which I thought was appropriate when we got together, the Ways and Means Committee got together in December, the one I thought that was appropriate that summarized what I think lies ahead now or characterizes now is Blue Skies, Nothing But Blue Skies. And I really do feel that way. One of the things that I remember last year when we got together and I said, I don't think this is good. I've never been as worried or concerned in my professional career. And that was because the bull market and the economic expansion was the longest, by a lot, was the longest we'd ever experienced since 1890. It was the longest in our history. And this year when we get together, and plus there were some other technical details which said that even though not only was it the longest in history, the technical details, things like the yield curve, leading indicators for the economy said, it's not gonna go much longer. And this year it's just the opposite. It's the second, believe it or not, the second shortest bull market in our history. And it's the shortest economic expansion, at least at this stage in our history. We're only at about the 10 or 11 month mark in both. And the average magnitude or duration of post-war bull markets and recoveries is about 63 months. Those are averages. They don't mean much, but it's worth keeping that in mind. This is not the point in time where you start to become very worried about about all of the risks that are associated with the recovery. You get worried about them, you talk about them, and we're talking about them. But quite frankly, it's going to be 2 years from today when we start to not only think about them, talk about them, worry about them, but the worries become very legitimate. So I think it's nothing but blue skies. I look at the performance. I always try to reconcile the performance of the financial markets with the performance of the economy, particularly look at the message of the markets. Investors collectively tend to get this right, not individually, but collectively tend to get it right. And quite frankly, the message is almost picture perfect. It's hard to imagine the message of the financial markets being more positive. Not only is the, and I'm not going to belabor all this, not only is the stock market going up, but the so-called bull market sectors are the top five sectors, the bear market sectors, the ones that people avoid during bull markets but don't avoid during bear markets are at the bottom of the list. Things like utilities and staples, the so-called safer sectors. Small companies are outperforming large companies. Investors are willing to take a lot more risk. You see that the spreads in the credit markets, the spread between the yield on a BAA corporate bond and a U.S. Treasury has narrowed, and that's true of junk bonds as well. The yield there and the yield on a Treasury has narrowed. That only occurs when investors are willing to take more risk or are becoming more optimistic about prospects for the economy. And as I said, importantly, investors tend to get it right. The yield curve, last year at this time, the yield curve was telling us fairly clearly signaling that the probability of a recession beginning in the next 12 months, and this is all the work that Jason does, he'll be talking to you. Jason won't take credit for this, believe me, but it's really actually pretty good work that's done by the Federal Reserve Bank of New York. Very good work, and I do pay attention to it. But last year at this time, it was telling us that the probability of a recession was very high. This year, that probability has gone down. As we look through 2020 and into 2021, it says the probability is pretty low. So the message of the financial markets is very positive. The question is it justified? Is there any way you can justify this very positive outlook or message that's coming from the financial markets? And the answer to that, I think, which has been answered already, is very clearly yes. If you take a look at monetary stimulus, it's nearly unprecedented. I think it is unprecedented, quite frankly. The level of monetary stimulus from the Federal Reserve having reduced their target for the federal funds rate from 1.5% to 1.75%. That was their range. Now it's 0 to 25 basis points. And having done that by adding reserves to the financial system, which has stimulated a significant amount of bank lending as well as money growth. Monetary growth rates right now, the money supply since the month of April growing at an average annual rate of 23.7%. The average rate since 1959, 6.8%. Now it's 23.7%. So we're getting significant growth in the money supply, the kind of thing that drives the economy and the financial markets. And as a result, liquidity conditions are very positive. When we get to the level of fiscal stimulus, that also I would have to say or argue is unprecedented. Not only as it shows up in the increase in the federal budget deficit, but also debt as a percentage of GDP. So we're seeing enough stimulus that says that the optimism that's being expressed by the financial markets or investors collectively is very justified. I've given you all a handout. I'm laboring through that handout. You have the handout. You can look at the handout as I'm talking. What I'm trying to give you here is just a little summary of the kind of the important points of it. One part of that handout, page 3 of that handout, you don't have to go to it, is some detail on what I take to be a sensible forecast for all of the kind of details which you're going to be wrestling with over the course of the near term. Forecasts for the economy and all the components of the economy, things like corporate profits, employment, S&P 500 prices, interest rates. Just a couple of things that I would say with regard to all of the details, and it's details of the national forecast as well as the New York State forecast. The only things I would say is that my forecasts are, quite frankly, I think on the low side. Chris did get to this, and his forecast is higher. But I also see when you talk about forecasts for 2020, 2021 for the national economy, I see forecasts of 6.5% from fairly sensible people, which is well above what I'm forecasting. Forecasts of 4% for 2022. Those are historically really big numbers, but believe me, based on what I think is going on, particularly when we take a look at the success, the prospective success of the vaccine, when we take a look at the fact that we're going to be changing containment, that recoveries are going to start to increase, and the lockdowns are going to start to decrease, that equation is going to start, the containment equation is going to start to improve. When we start to see all that, forecasts of 6.5% GDP for 2020 and 4% GDP for 2022 are not at all absurd. I see forecasts for the first quarter. Chris mentioned that it seems a little bit high when you see a forecast of 10% for the first quarter. I think that is too high, but I do see forecasts of 6 to 8%, and I don't think they're too high, particularly when I see the change that seems to have occurred as a result of the additional fiscal stimulus at the end of December and how it has showed up already in the retail sales number for the month of January, 5.3%, a pretty strong number. So I don't think 6 to 8% in the first quarter is an absurd number. And importantly, I don't think 6.5% for 2020 is at all an absurd number. In addition, all the other sort of details of the forecast, we're going to see an ongoing increase in the number of jobs that are created, although that number of jobs, the average number of jobs created on a monthly basis, is likely to slow down as we move down through 2021 and 2022. But nevertheless, positive growth in jobs as we go through the whole process of trying to recover the jobs that we lost when we dug that deep hole in March and April of 2020. In response to the comments that were made about inflation, we see a rise in the rate of inflation. It's gonna get, in my judgment, to the 2.3-2.4% level for 2020, maybe a little bit higher, not significantly so in 2000, and 22. I don't think, based on promises, I guess you'd call them promises made by the Federal Reserve, that we're going to see any change in Federal Reserve policy. Their target for the federal funds rate is likely to stay or remain at the 0 to 25 basis point level as we move through 2021 and 2022. I don't think the Federal Reserve is going to get to thinking about raising short-term interest rates or their target for the funds rate until we get to 2023. Guessing Federal Reserve policy, as everybody knows, is not the easiest thing in the world to do. So I think policy, as measured by the federal funds rate, is not going to really change. You'll also see in my handout some forecasts for short-term interest rates as well as longer-term interest rates. In both cases, I'm lower than the consensus. I think the consensus is, quite frankly, a little bit too bold or too high, particularly when we start to look at the 10-year Treasury. I don't think the level of rates forecast by the consensus, which gets up to 1.60 at the 1.60% on a 10-year Treasury at the end of 2022, that is inconsistent with the level of the federal funds rate or with Federal Reserve policy. So I think it'll go higher, but I don't think it's going to go significantly higher than it currently is. So so I'm not only lower, I would say that the consensus is probably wrong. When we get to the issue of stock prices generally, there are two things I just make mention of. I think we've come very far, very fast. First of all, as everybody knows, forecasting stock prices is, I'm not going to call it foolish, but I'm going to say it's pretty close to that. But it's not foolish. You can do it, and you can do it sensibly, and you can do it rationally. And I think I've done it sensibly, and I think I've done it rationally. But it's one of those things that it's pretty easy to be wrong. Right now, it appears to me that the stock market, and I think everybody's seen the performance in 2020 as being pretty unusually positive. But we're now about 7% to 8% overvalued, and the upside potential between now and the end of 2021, in my judgment, is negative or a minus 1.5%. That just really means we've come very far, very fast, and have become overvalued. There's still positive prospects between now and the end of 2022, but it's very limited. What I'm saying, or the forecast I'm giving you, incidentally, is very consistent with the performance of the financial markets in the first year after an election and the second year after an election. It's very consistent with financial market history. And we could go through that, but I know you don't want to go through that. The point being is that the stock market has come very far, very fast. It's very fully valued. And I think the potential for 2021 and 2022 is somewhat limited, certainly limited compared to the kind of performance that we saw in 2020. There's a lot I've got in here on New York State, or some comments on New York State. We could talk at length about New York State. I had forecast last year, and I think before last year, before we got together, that New York State would be, of all the states in New England, would be the best performing economy on the basis of gross state product as well as employment. It turned out to be the worst. And it turned out to be the worst, not because it has a very significant percentage of the state's economy is in the leisure and hospitality, arts, entertainment, et cetera. It's about a little over 4%. It's not a very big percentage of the total economy. But that the decline, the contraction in the second quarter 2020 was about 66% in that sector of the New York economy. And as a result of that, not only was there job losses, but obviously the economy performed very poorly. As poorly as the New York State economy performed, and largely because of the contraction in that sector, as poorly as it performed in 2020, in my judgment, 2021 and 2022, it's going to the top of the list, and the top of the list significantly. I think my forecast, and I've got some numbers in there on the New York State economy, my forecast for gross state product, I've got some pretty strong numbers, 5.4% for 21, 4.8% for 22. Payroll gains, we lost we lost on average 1 million. I've got 1,021,000 jobs. Well, we'll regain 887,000 jobs in 2021 and regain 379,000 jobs in 2022. So we're going to regain a lot of the jobs that we lost in 2020 are going to be recovered in 2021 and 2022. I know, Robert, you mentioned that you look at 2023 as the recovery in jobs or getting jobs back to the level. I think you said the jobs that to the level of that we saw in before the pandemic in 2019. I see that as sooner than that. I see the recovery in output as being the fourth quarter of this year and the recovery in jobs being about the second or third quarter of 2022. So a little bit sooner on the recovery. Still, it's going to be a frustrating process, but nevertheless, I think it's coming. My numbers on New York State personal income, I really look at my numbers on New York State and I compare them a little bit to the Ways and Means Committee. I looked at other numbers that I've looked at. My numbers are, quite frankly, for the national economy, for the New York State economy, are a bit stronger than I see others forecasting. And as a result of that, I ask myself, what is a level of revenues that's consistent with my forecast? And frankly, it comes out a little bit stronger than I see from other sources. So I think that the revenue picture for New York State might turn out to be a little bit better than people are expecting. Overall, what I'm saying, and it's in the report, and I'd love to talk about the details of the report, the details of the numbers with anybody who'd like to talk about it. But overall, I think the prospects, particularly when we get a look at the message of the financial market, are very, very positive for the national economy and the New York State economy as we look to 2021 and 2022, more optimistic, or it's going to be better than I think a lot of us are forecasting or expecting. And I think that's going to show up in revenues. It's hard for me to even say that because that's not the way I am. I'm usually very conservative and cautious on the side of forecasting revenues, but things look really good in my judgment for the national economy and for the New York State economy. So if you're, last year we said, if you're gonna err, you should err on the part of being cautious. This year, I'd say you should err on the other side.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. I'm gonna have a couple questions, but I'll save them for okay. Question period.
You bet.
So with that, I'm going to go to Jason Bram from the Federal Reserve Bank of New York. Jason.
Hi, Robert. Can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Very good. So Robert, you've become quite a celebrity over the past year. I used to see you on TV every day. So it's nice to see you again. I'm going to try to share my screen. Let's see. PowerPoint slideshow. Share. Okay, whoops, let's go to the beginning. Can everyone see this? This is the last slide, wait, hang on.
Yeah, we can see it. Home prices is what's up.
Okay, yeah, this is, let me go to the beginning. Sorry about that. Okay, that was my presentation backwards. So let me start off, of course, saying that the views I give are my own, not necessarily representing those of the Federal Reserve Bank of New York or the Federal Reserve System. Following on Hugh citing songs for this day, retro songs, I guess my theme would be an old Beatles song, It Won't Be Long. I think it won't be long to think before things get a lot better. And I think by the end of the year, we'll be singing Back in the New York Groove. Okay, and on that note, let me just give you a quick preview. I'm going to talk very, very briefly because I know we've pretty much covered this. I'm going to talk about the COVID spread, the disease itself around New York State, some measures of business activity and business sentiment, labor market trends. I'm going to have a bunch of charts on that. And I'm going to finish off with just a quick look at the housing markets across the district. So we've started reporting on our website. It's similar. We have it broken down a little differently. But we've been reporting on our website these sort of real-time charts that are based on the New York Times database about the coronavirus spread across the region. New York City, as you see, this goes up through a few days ago, I guess. New York City, you know, has followed the rest of the nation down, although it hasn't come down quite as much. Upstate New York seems to be following the nation, whereas New York City and the areas around have come down, but they're still a little bit on the high side. Now, you may look back at a year ago and say, wow, was it even higher than a year ago? So I just want to mention these are confirmed cases, and the numbers from last spring are vastly understated. So, you know, these are confirmed cases, but it was very, very hard to get tested, and there was probably a very substantial undercount. So if you look at positivity rates and such, those were much higher earlier on. Now, I'm not going to make any, obviously, the one thing I'm not going to predict is, you know, the outbreak of the pandemic. But obviously, as everyone here has said, the path of the economy is going to largely depend on that. Let me start off by talking about this data we've started getting from a company called Verisk. And they monitor real-time consumer spending, and they do it in pretty good geographic detail. This is based not on where the money is spent, but on the address of the account holder. But even so, you can basically see that you had this huge drop off with the lockdowns. Things have kind of come back, but in New York, in downstate New York, but mainly because of New York City, they've lagged still quite a bit. So, you know, the rest of the nation spending is pretty close to back to where it was before the pandemic. Again, this is credit card spending. This isn't necessarily a comprehensive measure, but it's a pretty good proxy, we think. And New York City, though, you know, is still lagging. And of course, New York City, for reasons that people here have mentioned, you've had some people, you know, leaving New York. You've had fewer people coming into New York. You have much less tourism, less business travel, and such. So New York City's economy has sort of taken the brunt of this. As opposed to like the last decade when New York City was sort of the engine of growth in New York. So let me talk a little bit about our business surveys. So you're probably aware of our Empire State Manufacturing Survey. That's sort of self-descriptive. Our Business Leader Survey is a survey of service sector firms and some construction firms, mostly in New York State, but also in Northern New Jersey and Connecticut. But it gives you a kind of a good idea. And you can see this, you know, record drop off. This is a diffusion index. So what the numbers mean is it's the number of people saying things were getting worse minus the number saying things are getting better. Obviously, at the beginning of the pandemic, it was very close to negative 100. In other words, basically everyone was saying things were getting worse and no one was saying things were getting better. And that has, you know, bounced back somewhat. But keep in mind that while the manufacturing index has gone above zero, so you've seen sort of steady improvement in manufacturing, the service sector index has remained negative, which means that, when you're asking businesses, are things getting better or worse, even as the whole economy has recovered, you've had more people say things are getting worse than getting better. And the numbers that we see in February, are comparable still to what you see, in a recession. So it's not clear that we've turned the corner, but one thing that I won't get into too much detail, but even within the service sector, obviously there's a whole lot of variation. And as we all know, the leisure and hospitality, hotels, entertainment, restaurants especially, have been hit hard especially in New York City. Now, we also ask questions about expected economic conditions. And here the numbers are much more, especially in February, promising. So probably because the pandemic has abated, there's been some reopenings across New York, and you know the vaccinations are starting to take hold, you've seen this big jump in optimism in the service sector. Now, obviously, when you ask people, do you think things are going to get better? It's compared to the current baseline, which of course is very negative, but it's still encouraging to see a whole lot more optimism than we've seen in a long time. I should mention also, as we do our surveys, we collect comments. You know, people are free to leave open-ended comments, and we always get a number of people saying, like, how can you ask us what we're expecting? Like, nobody knows anything. Like, there's just so much uncertainty. But at the same time, this is when expectations are the most important, because even if there's a lot of uncertainty, you know, the range of potential outcomes is just varies a whole lot. So I'm very encouraged by this, even though, you know, obviously a lot of people are like, yeah, I'm optimistic, but, you know, don't hang your hat on that. We also ask special questions in our surveys. This one was from December, I believe. Yeah, it was from last December. So we just asked companies about, you know, how much did your wages change in the past year? And the nice thing is that we've been doing it for many years. And you can see that the numbers had been getting up above 3%, both past and expected. And then, of course, this past year, there's actually, on average, been a decline in wages, which is not all that surprising. And a lot of that, again, is in sort of the leisure and hospitality, but also in a number of other, you know, customer-facing type industries. What's a little more encouraging is that the expected, and this is more than I think just expectations, because a lot of companies, you know, have to budget their wages a year out. So you're looking at about a 3% expected wage gain on average in 2021. So that, those are the darker bars. And then these are the same numbers for the manufacturing sector, where you see the actual, I guess call it here, not a decline, but a deceleration in wages was not as severe. And that's sort of bouncing back too. So all this is very, very encouraging. Turning to employment, I'm just gonna show some charts. Let me explain a little bit about these early benchmark estimates. So as probably some of you know, who follow these numbers very closely, every March, the numbers, the employment numbers get revised. They sort of get trued up to what is the quarterly census of employment and wages. Apologize for the jargon, but basically the very, very complete data on employment come in with like a 6 month delay, and once a year it gets trued up, so it gets revised. And so we do that on a quarterly basis. It's called our early benchmark estimate. So if you look at New York State, the gray line, if you can see it, is what the numbers show right now up through December, which is the latest available. And then our early benchmark estimates are pretty much in line with those. So in other words, we don't expect them to be revised a whole lot for New York State. However, in upstate New York, we see a little bit of an upward revision. I did put in New Jersey, just so you could see that it's kind of similar. And then I'm not gonna get into too much detail, but New York City has had the biggest decline. I should also mention, by the way, that some numbers came out this morning, which I didn't have a chance to get into the chart. Up through the third quarter of 2020. But just in getting a quick look at them, it looks like New York City might get revised down just a tiny bit. And the rest of the state, some areas like Rochester and Syracuse may actually get revised up a little bit, but no major differences. And so what you see in all these areas is this sort of steep drop off, a quick comeback. And then, you know, as the pandemic lingered and you had, you know, shutdowns again, and you had this, second or third wave, I guess in this region, it's the second wave, you saw a bit of a drop off, and you're seeing that throughout the region. But again, most of the weakness is in New York City, and I'll get into that in a little bit. I know we have a lot of metro areas here. Now, let me move on to what I think is probably the most interesting and important point I'm gonna try to make during this presentation. And this is something that we, unfortunately, have a lot of experience with, which is natural disasters. And, you know, so since I've been at the Fed, we've had the 9/11 attack. We've had Hurricane Sandy in New York. We've had Hurricanes Maria and Irma in Puerto Rico and the Virgin Islands, which even though I know we're not too concerned about that, but is part of our district. And so we've had a chance to do a lot of research on the effects of natural disasters on the economy. And early in the pandemic, I think in April or May, we actually put out a blog post saying that the pandemic, it should be thought of more as a natural disaster. You know, people were comparing it to the recession. And if you look at this chart here, this is what we call a spider chart. So everything's indexed to the start of the crisis. So in the case of the recession, the start of the recession, in the case of the pandemic, it's set to February 2020. And you see, if you just compare it to a recession, it looks much, much more serious initially. But every single natural disaster we've looked at has followed this pattern, which is a steep drop off and then a pretty sharp rebound. Now, this rebound, of course, wasn't all that sharp because the pandemic, unlike a hurricane, didn't just sort of vanish. So, but you can see here, we've just put a couple examples here of similar disasters. And even though the magnitudes are different, you can see Puerto Rico after the hurricane, the Virgin Islands actually did a little worse after the hurricane. And then the sort of poster child of disasters was Hurricane Katrina. But even there, even though you saw a huge drop, you saw a comeback, and then it sort of never quite, I shouldn't say never, but as of a few years after, it didn't get back to the current situation, you know, pre-hurricane situation. Now, one thing you have to be aware of with Katrina, which isn't true of the pandemic, is that, and to some extent with Puerto Rico, is that you had a whole lot of people and businesses literally moving out. So, you know, even as the hurricane left, there was still flooding. There were a lot of mold issues throughout the region. And there was, of course, the insurance and the fear that you might get another and how susceptible the area was to hurricanes. So what you saw after Hurricane Katrina is not likely to happen in this, because even though you've had a little bit of a population decline in New York City, which I can talk about in a minute, but it's not anything on the same magnitude as what you saw in the New Orleans area after Hurricane Katrina. So I think the other thing, you know, with these things flattening out, keep in mind that the pandemic is still with us. And so it's quite plausible. And this isn't a prediction, because I don't like to make predictions. And I'm glad I didn't make one at this time last year. But whatever the forecasts are, I think there's a lot of upside, as Hugh and others have sort of mentioned. I think there's a lot of upside potential or risk, whatever you want to call it, in the sense that once the pandemic goes away, if it eventually turns out like a natural disaster, you get a snapback. The reason I put New Orleans and Puerto Rico is those were the two most persistent natural disaster effects on economies. And so if you look at New York after Sandy, if you look at Houston after Harvey, things got back to pre-disaster levels within just a couple months. So, you know, I'm not saying that it's going to be quite that quick here, but I do think there's a good deal of upside potential. All right, I'm not going to get into this. Unemployment, obviously, we've had a huge spike. It's come down. Again, New York City is the laggard here in the sense that, you know, it's still a lot higher than the nation and the state and labor force participation. You see the same sort of thing. Let me look at now a couple key industries in New York City, the most key one being the securities industry. This chart, which I'm sure everyone's sick of seeing because I show it almost every year, just sort of emphasizes that in New York City, the securities industry leads basically every major economic cycle. So, you know, when securities and industry employment peaks, which is the beginning of these gray areas, you get a, it starts to go down. And then sure enough, within a year or so, employment in every other sector goes down. And then when employment in securities comes back, everything else seems to follow. And so the securities industry is a leading indicator of New York City. Now, one of the things that makes this recession different is that it wasn't led by the securities industry. And in fact, Wall Street and other financial sectors in New York City, for obvious reasons, were not as, you know, were not all that affected, you know, if both compared to past recessions, and of course, compared to sectors like leisure and hospitality. So this gives me some hope that, you know, the level of employment, you know, the securities industry and in other industries that sort of lead New York City, as long as they remain, you know, fairly resilient, which they have, I'm pretty optimistic about the outlook for New York City. This is just a sort of a magnified view of the past few years. I'm also going to talk about the tech sector, which I won't get into. Some people call it TAMI, technology, advertising. I forget what it's called, technology, advertising, media, and information or something like that. So it's basically the information technology and creative industries. And we've been showing this for a while that it's been catching up to the securities industry, and now it's caught up. And in fact, for the first time, I think jobs in these sectors outnumber those in the securities industry in New York City. And as was the case with securities, this sector also wasn't that affected. So you have this strange situation in New York City where, and by the way, all the weakness in New York City, the extent to which New York State's weakness is looking worse than the nation, and even New York City's working less than the nation, is basically all in Manhattan. So if you were to take out Manhattan, New York City would look a lot more like the nation. And if you, of course, you can't take out Manhattan, but I'm just saying hypothetically. And if you took out Manhattan, New York State would also look a lot more like the nation. And the thing is, it's not even the key industries in New York City. What it is, I shouldn't say key industries, I should say the major income sectors. You've had just dramatic declines in so many of the industries that rely on people being present. So, you know, so corporations in Midtown, in downtown Manhattan, are still functioning remotely, but the bars, the restaurants, the Broadway theaters, the restaurants that people go to after theaters, and all this kind of activity in New York City, nail salons, has been affected by the remote work. And so to the extent that the office population and visitors come back to New York City, these sectors in New York City should rebound. I'm gonna wrap up because I feel like I've taken like a long time here. I'm just gonna wrap up with a few charts on home prices. This is a repeat sales index that we use. It goes up to December. Early in the pandemic, there was a lot of concern that, of course, things like housing would be adversely affected, but actually housing markets have been really, really strong. And house prices have accelerated. And one of the reasons, obviously, is that, you know, people's homes are now their homes and offices to a large extent. People are spending more time at home. People are, you know, moving to somewhat bigger homes. This has been going on, you know, for quite a few months, as soon as, you know, people were able to be mobile a little bit. And you can see that uniformly across New York State and across the nation, you've seen this acceleration in home prices. Even in Long Island, in Queens, and in Manhattan and in Brooklyn, you don't see the same kind of acceleration, but you also don't see that big of a drop off. So rents, this is anecdotally, but I think there's data to back it up. Rents in Manhattan and throughout New York City have dropped substantially. You know, we do our Beige Book report. So we collect a lot of anecdotal information, and, you know, rents are down 20 to 25%. And prices yet are, you know, have, I won't say they've, you know, remained steady because they have come down, but they haven't come down nearly as much as rents. And to some extent, this likely reflects, obviously, the change, you know, changing, you know, mortgage rate environment, but it also probably reflects people's expectations. So, you know, in terms of, you know, the rental market is affected by supply and demand. Supply hasn't really changed. Demand has gone down because fewer people are in the city. But I think people's prices tend to reflect people's expectations for the future path of rents and housing prices. And so those have not come down nearly as much. I'm just going to, I think, here's some more areas around New York City that, you know, you see this pattern that everywhere literally outside New York City, prices have accelerated. And then in upstate New York, things really have, you know, gone very, you know, things were already very strong. Obviously at lower levels than in New York City, but certainly the trend in home prices in upstate New York has been, you know, above, I would say, even what's been going on nationally. So before I recap, I just want to make one more statement. And that is, you know, there's a lot of concern about the population decline. The Cleveland Fed, I should have had a link to it, but the Cleveland Fed recently did a study based on our consumer credit panel data that showed that there's been a bit of a population loss in urban areas. They define it in terms of census tracts. I think most of New York City would probably classify as urban in their definition. And they found something that we also found just looking at New York City. They found it was true nationwide, which is that there's been a modest decline in the population in New York City, not huge. And it doesn't reflect so much people, you know, moving out, although some people obviously have moved out, but it reflects the fact that New York City always has this churning, you know, people moving in, people retiring, moving to Florida, people moving away from the city when they have kids sometimes, or just people moving away for other reasons. So you have this constant churning in New York City. And where the effect has been most pronounced is not so much in people, more people leaving, but just not as many people coming to the city. And we've even seen this, you know, at the Fed, you know, people who start in New York, you know, who are onboarded and sort of remote, you know, if they've been in, you know, some place where, you know, they've been going to college or where they've been living, that is more likely than not a less expensive place to live. A lot of people have sort of stayed put there. They've started work, they've started their jobs in New York. And eventually, presumably, they'll move to New York. But that sort of inflow of people that you usually see, in addition to the inflow of, you know, immigrants, has slowed up a lot. And so for that reason, I'm not too worried about the population decline in New York City. It's not like the 1970s where kind of lots and lots and lots of people were leaving. I'm not gonna read through this recap, but it's there for anyone to look at. And I know you're gonna take questions at the end. So I will conclude with that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jason. Next, we will go to Kajal Lahiri of the State University of New York at Albany.
Thank you. Let me share my slide. Okay. So I thank you, all of you, for inviting me here. Hopefully, I'm the last but not the least, and I'll be very brief. But before that, I must share with you some of the thoughts of this budget forecasting that I've been working on for the last 2-3 years, and particularly with a whole bunch of my master's students and also a current PhD student, Cheng Yang. And the way I look at it, is, you know, we are talking about a lot of data, different data coming in. So at the end of the day, the question is, how do you cook the sausage, right? At the end of the day, the DOB has to come up with a number, say next year revenue forecast, and hopefully there'll be quantitative estimate of the uncertainty. A lot of us talking about uncertainty of the budget forecast. So, and then what happens when the DOB comes up with a number, then all the parties negotiate on this, whether it is 68 billion or 65 billion and so on. That's the bottom line. And also the timing is also important. When does the executive group starts forecasting? If you see that, it will be maybe 16 months before the end of a fiscal year. So the way I look at it is that you have to start forecasting year-over-year growth rate in revenues, okay, 16 or 18 months before the end of the fiscal year, and very often those forecasts are revised. So that means that you have to get new data. As the new data comes in, and the forecasts are revised, and the negotiations continue. For example, the latest is the update of the executive budget came like 2 days ago, right? And that means at that point, they had to have the latest data with which they update the latest forecast for revenue growth for next academic year, fiscal year, which is going to start in 1 or 2 months. Right? That's the scenario. So that tells me that so DOB, mostly they work with quarterly data. First job is to have high frequency data if you have to forecast properly. And these days, you know, data come, high frequency means it comes with different lags, data comes with different lags, something monthly, something weekly, some annual, and so on. So you have to allow all the data that can come in, whatever frequency they come in, and whatever lag they come in, you should be able to use it in your real-time forecasting, okay? And then the other issues is that very often you see New York State revenue forecast is affected by different things. Today, we are hearing a lot of macro economic variables from the US economy. We know that the US economy affects New York State revenue. We also, Jason talked about New York. We know New York State variables affect that New York State revenue, right? So New York State cycle in the tax revenue, this is not the same thing as the business cycle. We know there have been work in Albany, which shows that the cycles are different. So you have to bring in independently the role of US economic factors on New York State revenue, the role of New York State variables on the New York State tax revenue, and then finally the dynamics of the New York State tax revenue itself. That data possibly comes every month. So it is, so what you're doing is at best you're using monthly data or weekly data. Stock prices come weekly, and you are estimating an annual figure, which is year over growth rate in tax revenue. That's the bottom line. That is what we are in the business of doing. Question is, you collect all these data, and how do you put them together? Unless you put them together in a model, you'll never be able to get the underlying uncertainty of the forecast. For example, right now, the DOB estimate says 86 billion dollar revenue expected next year. Question is, what is the uncertainty of that point forecast? That uncertainty cannot be just upside and downside statement. It has to be precise number that you say plus minus 4 billion would be the 95% confidence interval. You need those quantitative numbers. It so happens that in revenue forecasting, not only New York State, across the country, nobody has these models developed, okay? Even though in macroeconomics, they have been developed. If you go to New York Fed, they have a weekly model of nowcasting. You go to Philly Fed, they have a weekly model, Aroba Dewol model. So this is happening in the macroeconomic scenario. It has not come to local government revenue forecast. And that's what precisely I've been doing with my students in SUNY Albany. We have developed a model, and you see the role of US economy is important, all of us agree. For example, I'll give an example. Last year, this time when we met, right, we are expecting different things, but we didn't know that the economy is slowing down, US economy, at that point, okay? And nobody forecasted that. So at that point, our forecast was 6 to 4, you know, a rosy picture we're giving all of them. But what happened if you think about it, the current recession that came in the USA, everybody is blaming on the COVID. But the fact is that the NBR dating committee has dated February to be the beginning of a turning point of the current recession. So that recession, NBR dating committee has said, it started before the COVID had begun. Okay, so that means that last year, this time, economy was slowing down, and the budget forecasters should have anticipated that it would have an effect on the revenue forecasting. So last time, we missed it again. We missed the, you know, slowing down the macroeconomy, how it affect the, this. So our model goes in the following way. We have 18 separate models for 18 horizons, beginning with, you know, 18 months ahead. So we keep on, we have a model with, we have three different models. One is how, we, then I'll give you some graphs here, like you're seeing and how they look, okay? But point is that we have separate models. It's a high frequency model called Midas model. So you have monthly data, you need monthly, weekly data to predict yearly target. No? And we've been doing it for the last 2 years, and I'll show you how it works. It has been working out pretty good. So these are some of the data. And bottom line, I'll leave out, if you talk about the uncertainty, right now, the point forecast that we are getting, say, at the horizon 14 months, right? We are 14 months ahead forecast right now. It comes with a huge uncertainty, almost plus minus $4 to $5 billion. We have to accept it, no matter what point forecast you give. Okay, that's the bottom line. We have studied this, and if you want later, I can share my manuscript with this. We have done bootstrap the forecast uncertainty, precise number. Huh? Now, If you like some of the data, I'll show you. And I'd be happy to answer later on. These are technical papers I can on a different workshop I can and tell. So, you know, last year what happened is that, around after the COVID, the first thing is the unemployment claims. It sort of shattered every record everywhere. New York State leading indicators from Philadelphia, all they stopped creating leading indicators and coincidentally because they didn't know how to handle this break actually. And then if you go more, this is the transportation services index that US transportation department puts out. I actually created from SUNY Albany because every month you see how it fell. And the interesting thing is that the US sector, the you can see the passenger really fell, okay? The overall fell, but the freight index didn't fall that much, as much as I show you what happened in New York State, okay? Then if you go forward on leading index, you can see that it for the US economy, it fell, but it's coming back on, right? So you see the recovery that a lot of people here has pointed out. Now, this is a little troubling here. Now, this is the Google Mobility Index for New York City. Okay, this is average retail recreational workplace activity. What you see following COVID, it really had a V-shaped recovery. Then it kind of leveled off. And lately, it is actually going down. So this actually shows you that the activities, which is New York City's main activities, that is not picking up that much, at least this indicator, the Google Mobility, that lately a lot of people are using in very, very high frequency because this data come daily. Okay. Now, if you look at, now this is interesting. This is the traffic around New York City area, Port Authority. Okay. And these are the data I took great pain in trying to collect. They're not really the available. And it comes from Port Authority indicators. And if you see that it sharply fell, right? This is the auto traffic around Pennsylvania, New Jersey, New York area. And then it sharply came back. It is almost back to the normal, right? This auto traffic. Now, if you look at truck traffic, which represents the business, you see it fell tremendously, unlike the national economy, right? But then it has recovered mostly. By this time, it is back to almost zero level. It has not gone exceeded it, but it has come back, right? If you look at another variable, New York electricity generation, you see it has gone down tremendously because in New York City, a lot of the rental properties are not used and so on. And you don't see too much of recovery. Yeah, this is what the latest I'm telling you is from yesterday's data. Hmm? Now this is of course U.S. economy consumer expectations. It is not that good. It is on the average, right? It has not exceeded that zero value. Now our state coincident indicator. You know that DOB had created this many years ago, and these things being now distributed in different Federal Reserve banks, and the state New York State coincident indicator, it fell sharply. It's coming back sharply, but you know where we stand right now. Okay, it is halfway there. We're not yet back. Now blue chip, we talked about it, right? The forecast for next year GDP growth, it again, blue chip comes every month. So that helps, right? So the high frequency data, monthly data. And it is, of course, as you know, people are expecting next year the GDP growth almost 5%. It is falling a little bit lately, but is high up there, right? Another variable that has attracted a lot of economists' attention these days is the economic policy uncertainty. This is United States, okay? And you see that post-COVID, economic policy uncertainty really shoot up. And people have studied this, that this policy uncertainty really affects investment, consumption, everything. And good news is that, you see, that policy uncertainty is coming down very sharply, even though that uncertainty has not come down to a natural level yet. Okay, so we are living with this. And this affects, you know, durable consumption on durable goods, investment, and so on, very well known. And this is, now this is our dearest thing. This is our New York State revenue, you know, fund time series, sort of smooth a little bit. And you see that in the middle of the recession, this is the July surge we got this time, right? Because the tax filing date was deferred from March to July. And no wonder in the July, you saw a huge surge in income tax return, and you got a lot of money, you know, in collection. And that is part of the reason I think a lot of people are thinking that, well, tax receipts are coming back, and we can be a lot more positive than otherwise. So, you know, these are the variables that are US variables we have assembled in Albany, SUNY Albany. Many variables, nobody used them. We have gone out and collected them. They are supposed to forecast US recession, okay? Because I believe US recession affects our tax revenue. That kicks in there. Then you have, these are the New York State variables. Many of the variables are not readily available. We have to work a lot from SUNY Albany to collect this data. It can still be done more. And so we have a different model how New York State. And well, one thing I'll tell you, what we found out is that right now, when you're forecasting New York State revenue for next fiscal year, it is these models, the New York State model and US model, that actually contributes to the forecasting capability of next year. It is not New York State taxes. New York State tax start kicking in once we enter the fiscal year. Then it really, these variables go away. So 6 months ahead, they have almost no role. US variables are New York State variables. At that point, it is the dynamics in the monthly New York State taxes that forecast the best. But at this point, which is 14 months ahead the end of the next fiscal year, it is these macro variables, New York State and US variables, that are the variables that contribute to whatever forecast value or forecast we are doing for next academic, for fiscal year. So a US factor, so what we do is we collect all these data and then create one factor out of all the US variables. And you can see how it looks like, right? It failed and coming back. This is New York State factor based on all New York State variables. You see how it came? The main important point is that New York factor is not the same as US factor. They're different, okay? And this is not new. The work at Assembly and DOB, they have found this out many years ago that we move in a different way, okay? And so that has to be sort of recognized when scientifically, on the basis of data, we make a forecast for, New York State, general fund tax revenue. Okay, and this is a New York City cycle. My point is that, you see, New York's tax cycle is not the same as US economic cycle. See how much many more up and down it goes. People who work with taxes, they know it. I found this out by doing this thing. But so when you forecast correctly, we have to recognize that New York tax cycles are different from US business cycles. Okay. So these are the thing, and let me stop here because not take anybody's time. But I'm glad I could share my thoughts. I've been working very hard for the last 3-4 years, developing a model for New York State revenue forecast. In the whole United States, nobody has this model, nobody. The way you took it down. And if any one of you who do this forecast want to use, I'd be very happy to share this. We have a program here. And so thank you very much. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to continue. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Lahiri. Next, we'll go to Jared Walchek from the Tax Foundation. Jared.
Thank you. I really appreciate the opportunity to spend a few minutes with you towards the end of this meeting. I am Jared Walchek with the Tax Foundation. Let me attempt here to share my screen, if you'll just give me one moment, and you know we should have that up now. Other presenters were able to provide you with some song lyrics to indicate where we might be heading. I did not bring you any of those today. Others also had a lot of great data on helping you formulate these projections and these estimates that you're working with. Where I think that I can bring something and I want to discuss briefly is some of the policy considerations that arise from this. I want to talk just a little about what the revenues look like and then talk from there about what the responses in the state can be. This is a cumulative chart looking at state tax revenues in calendar year 2019 versus 2020. Now, this is calendar year. This is not fiscal year. So, of course, your fiscal year begins in April. But what you'll note is, of course, that for the most part, the divergence was the delayed income tax collections, which, of course, lots of states experienced where you know, those were pushed later into the year. The collections actually are only down about 1% in the last calendar year versus 2019. Obviously, there are projections of a $15 billion deficit. A couple of things are going on there. One, of course, is that the state's spending, just the expenditures anticipated continue to rise. Obviously, the state was looking at almost a $7 billion shortfall even before the COVID-19 pandemic that needed to be closed. So there's that gap that exists. And also, I mean, I think understandably, you know, there's still, you know, a conservative estimate going into where things stand. But the good news is that through the end of calendar 2020, the collections have largely been stable. In fact, 2020 was the state's second highest collections year ever in real inflation adjusted terms behind only 2019. And I think that that's important to put in context, not to say this is good. The state's needs are rising and revenues clearly have not risen to match that, but to put it in context when we're thinking about what some of the responses could be, because there's the potential for, I think, overreaction that could have some adverse effects. So, you know, I want to talk a little about how the state plans for the future. There is just a reality that greater workplace mobility is here to stay. It's going to make it far easier for people to make decisions based on really whatever they care about. It may be the tax code, it may be the cost of living, it may be amenities they do or do not care about, but suddenly individuals can make far more choices because we have what I've been talking about as a partial unbundling. Generally speaking, we have to go where the jobs are, or you know, our employers have to go where sort of the median employee that they want in their workforce is going to be. And New York City in particular is a really attractive place for a lot of businesses, obviously in finance, but in many other areas as well, there's an excellent workforce there. But not every single person who's working for a New York company necessarily gets everything out of New York City that New York City offers or that the state offers. Some people love the amenities, both the government services, but also the cultural amenities. Some people don't care and they're paying for them regardless. And those costs may not be that relevant to them. Now we can unbundle. Employers and individual employees alike can make more personalized location decisions. And that's going to force the city and the state, and not just New York, to find new ways to compete in an era of dramatically increased, you know, mobility. And of course, higher income and higher net worth individuals are going to be the most mobile. That has always been the case, but that is even more so now that many of these white collar jobs, especially for these higher income individuals, really can follow you anywhere you want. In the short term, the convenience rules that have been much discussed, and I think they were discussed in a hearing yesterday, that continues to raise revenue from remote employees, people who once were working in an office in New York, but may now not be. Now, it's not unlimited. If you're working for a large company that has offices many places, they may be assigned to an office outside of New York. But you know, if you're assigned to a New York office and now you're choosing to work in another state remotely, you're still paying New York income taxes. That's good in the short term. In the longer term, it could lead to office relocations or at least changes in office structures for businesses that really want to provide that remote work flexibility. So, you know, there's the one caveat and proviso, you know, what happens if the Supreme Court does step in? There's the New Hampshire, Massachusetts case, but there's also the secondary consideration, even if New York continues to have this authority, what does it mean for the state's attractiveness to a certain class of business going forward? In the short term, it's certainly a revenue raiser. In the long term, that may not be the case. And you know what I really think, and I'll emphasize throughout this short presentation, is that New York has to be careful. Revenues are not down a lot yet. There are revenue assumptions that in some ways assume that maybe some of the people who've left are not coming back. And that depends. I mean, that's different from perhaps the state's official forecast, but you look at some of the discussions around this, and there are these clear fears. What if we do not have the ability to bring back many of the people who temporarily left during the COVID-19 pandemic once it ends? And New York really can't let the fear of that migration-induced revenue decline become a self-fulfilling prophecy. You see some of these proposals for dramatically increasing tax burdens on those who have stayed, or by those that the state needs to bring back in post-pandemic. And one of the most unfortunate things I think the state could do would be to make really dramatic adjustments, fearing that they're not bringing those individuals back in, and then making it that self-fulfilling prophecy where people do not want to return, businesses do not wish to return. So, that is sort of a theme of what I'm going to be discussing, but let's put this briefly in context in New York. New York's personal tax burden is the second highest in the nation. It's an effective average rate of 8.1%, that's second only to Hawaii at 8.4%, and it's more than 40% higher than the national average. The New York business tax burden, it's always a little tough to do per employee comparisons. I know that's not perfect across states, but still, $10,400 in business taxes per employee compared to a U.S. average of $6,500. It's the fourth highest, but it's actually in some ways worse than that, because the only states that are higher than you, maybe ones you wouldn't expect, they're North Dakota, Wyoming, and Alaska, and that's simply because they have so much collections from severance and oil pipeline property taxes that they have this massive amount of revenue that's not really associated with the labor in the state. In any state where the labor market is what's being taxed, you have, by a pretty significant margin, the highest per employee business tax burdens in the country. Which just creates this fiscal capacity question as you think about what your options are for responding to revenues that, while certainly not plummeting, are lower than desired, anticipated. What sort of capacity do you have? And there are a lot of tax proposals on the table, and I promise you, I'm not talking about all of these today, but there's everything from a mark-to-market taxation of capital gains income proposal, stock transfer tax, higher millionaires tax, digital advertising taxes like what was just adopted in Maryland, consumer data taxes, sales tax base broadening, adjustments to the corporate incentives, change in the income tax rate reductions for New York City, a PITER tax authorization, lots of different things. I do want to very briefly discuss implications of a few of the more significant of these, starting with the so-called Billionaire Mark-to-Market Tax Act. This is Senate Bill 8277. This would treat unrealized capital gains on billionaires' assets, and it is just billionaires, as taxable income, beginning with the first year catch-up period for unrealized gains. So it's supposed to raise a ton of revenue in the first year, but then on a consistent basis, is it supposed to raise $5.5 billion a year? I think there's probably some questions. I mean, that's a challenging number to get your hands around. I'm not sure $5.5 billion is the right number. It also doesn't assume any migration based on this, which I think could be substantial. But this is seen as a workaround to a constitutional constraint. The state constitution does not allow intangible personal property to be taxed on an ad valorem basis. And of course, wealth is intangible personal property. And it also says that undistributed profits cannot be taxed. So there becomes this constitutional question. Firstly, are unrealized capital gains economic income, or are they intangible property? I've written a paper where we discuss this. I do think that, economically, yes, you can think of this as, economic income, but it's not a taxable flow. I think there are some real constraints, but let me talk more about just the economic implications here. Administratively, how do you value the appreciation of a non-traded asset? Business income is really the issue here. We're not talking about shares traded in publicly traded corporations. You can clearly value those, whatever other problems there may be. But for closely held or private businesses, you look at some of the companies that get acquired for 10 or hundreds of times what people thought they were worth. How do you make that assessment? What happens if a high assessment means that there's not the liquidity to make this payment? This becomes a very significant issue for a lot of business owners. And yes, these are really wealthy people. So we can talk about fair share, but what happens to New York State if we start breaking up businesses to make these payments because of assessments that may or may not actually reflect their market worth? Research also indicates that the long run elasticity of capital gains with respect to taxation is between negative 0.6 and negative 0.8. So that means that a 10% increase in tax rates on capital gains would lead to approximately a 7.9% reduction in capital gains. It is fairly significant. And just something to be aware of, that there could really be migration around a policy like this. No state does this. Federal government obviously does not do this. Only one country, I believe, has ever tried it. So it's a fairly unique proposal. Similarly, the stock transfer tax. Obviously, this is not entirely new. New York used to have one of these. In fact, proposals have largely been around restoring something that's currently abated. They are, however, very rare. There are other countries that have had them. Most of them have repealed them. In recent years, Germany, Japan, the Netherlands, Sweden, and others have repealed them. The International Monetary Fund has indicated that they're highly uncompetitive and have shifted a lot of activity out of those countries. One of the real big issues, though, is that there's a huge difference between a national level one and a state level one, especially in our modern society. The major exchanges have obviously threatened to leave if such a tax is imposed. And to some degree, you can say, well, of course they threatened to leave. I mean, the threat's different than a reality, and that's a, a great bargaining point. But the financial services industry directly employs 8% of the New York City workforce. It generates 20% of the city gross product. And by the broader measure of financial activities, that's 29% of gross state product, not just New York City, but gross state product. And it's an industry that's already to some degree in decline. At the end of 2019, before the pandemic, the financial industry had declined for 5 consecutive quarters within New York City. And the comptroller's office noted that technological innovation and the relocation of jobs to lower cost geographies were driving this. There's a real fear, I think, that you could open the relocation floodgates if New York chose to impose punitive taxes on one of its most important and way more mobile than ever before industries. The International Monetary Fund said that these types of taxes create distortions that militate against their use, that they raise the cost of capital, they reduce liquidity, they slow price discovery. That all is assuming that someone pays the tax. But the reality is that it's easier for markets to shift in this country than across countries, and it's easier than ever before for this to happen. In 2003, the New York City Independent Budget Office concluded that going back to half of the rate that's currently proposed would eliminate 60,000 private sector jobs. Again, today's proposal is twice that, but I think even more important, they put out a worse scenario that, quote, desertion of the city-based stock exchanges may be a real threat, particularly with the increasing competitiveness of the electronic exchange. That was 17 years ago. I think that we're in a situation where that is much more realistic now. And also I would note here, revenue estimates on this need to be taken with a grain of salt. In some ways, they're based on something real. There are, in fact, returns that have this information on them because this is a rebated tax. But there's also no skin in the game. There's no liability based on this. So, when companies do planning around this, when they actually care about the accounting, when the state cares about the auditing, the numbers may be different than the numbers you see right now. There are also, of course, proposals for higher millionaires taxes. And the budget director spoke a little about where the tax situation is right now, talking a little about that New York does have some of the higher taxes in the nation, but also taxes that are very heavily concentrated on high income earners. One proposal would raise the top rate by 3 percentage points to 11.82%. That would yield a 15.696% top rate in New York City. That would obviously be the highest in the country. Now, the top 1% of wage earners currently pay about 42% of New York income taxes. I believe that the director indicated that the top 2% pay over 50%. Filers with more than 1 million in taxable income represent only 0.6% of taxpayers in the state, but report 15.2% of all small business income and 74.3% of all capital gains income. So this is not really a question of, in fairness, do they pay more? It's a question of, especially in an increasingly mobile economy, what is the risk of driving them away? New Jersey's Treasury Department did an analysis that after their tax increases in the early 2000s, that between 2004 and 2009, their income tax increase resulted in the loss of 20,000 taxpayers and $2.4 billion in removed gross income. Separately, a study by Boston College looked at the same thing and saw a net inflow of $98 billion in household wealth in the years 5 years prior to that tax increase, and a net outflow of $70 billion in the 5 years subsequent to it. And while it's not clear that this will be an immediate congressional priority, President Biden did have a tax plan that he proposed during the campaign, which if that were adopted and New York adopted these higher rates, would yield an all-in top marginal rate of 65.03% in New York City. That's a really high rate. It's the rate at which people do make decisions. There's been discussion already here about the effect of the state and local tax deduction, the cap, and the degree to which that may have driven migration. Now, obviously, that's very anecdotal at this point. We at the Tax Foundation have argued that this may not be as large of an effect as some believe, but it clearly has some effect on the margin. That is effectively a 1.31% percentage point rate increase. With these combined state and federal proposals, that'd be a 14.29% percentage point increase above the pre-TCJA levels. This is very large. These are just things that I think need to be taken into consideration when we're talking about this. Again, this self-fulfilling prophecy issue, not to say that there are not revenue needs, but do some of these make the problem so much worse given the enhanced degree to which migration is now possible? Are there things, though, that could be better? I think there are, to the extent that there does need to be additional revenue. Sales tax modernization is one possible area. New York's sales tax base is one of the narrowest in the country. One of the common ways of measuring this is sales tax revenue as a percentage of personal income. Obviously, it wouldn't be 100% of personal income, even in like a perfect sales tax base, but New York's is 25.71%. That is incredibly narrow. It is one of the narrowest in the country. Most of them are at least in the 30s. Many are in the 40s or even higher. This represents about 34% of theoretically taxable personal consumption. And the sales tax base was 56% of personal income in 1970. It's 50 years ago, but it's been halved since then. And base broadening can be both a revenue raiser, but also something that stabilizes collections, making them more predictable, and it's progressive, especially to the degree that you can tax untaxed services, which tend to be consumed by higher income and higher net worth individuals. It's something that no state's been particularly good at. Most states are honestly pretty bad at, but New York is worse than the average state by a significant margin in an area where there's a progressive change that could generate additional revenue and increase revenue stability. Obviously, there's been discussion of legalizing and taxing gaming and marijuana. We have some resources on how to structure that, and we've been talking with revenue officials in the state about the best ways to approach this, especially on marijuana. I think it is clearly a viable revenue source. One needs to be cautious about this, especially to the degree that, some of it may be ad valorem, that if we get federal legalization of marijuana, those prices come crashing down as you have interstate competition on that. So specific taxes preserve that revenue stream better and may also better approach what you're trying to accomplish. And then finally, I'm going to wrap it up here because I see that we are late, revisiting costly tax incentives. The film tax incentive costs $420 million a year, creates almost no jobs. And I know if you look at some of the studies, you'll see the state claiming, and I'm sorry to critique this, but the state claims that it created 967,000 jobs between 2011 and 2019. Where are they? That state employment rose by 1.17 million. Was that 82% of job growth? If you look at actual data, there's 5,400 more people in the broad motion picture and sound recording industry. That was 10% growth. It was about the same rate as pre-credit. If every job was attributable to credit, that's $775,000 per job created. And studies in other states show that these return like 6 to 11% of the value of the credits. Even the Excelsior job credit program, clearly far better, actually incentivizing something good, job creation. There's a lot of studies that show these are not as effective as they could be. And there may be an opportunity, it's scheduled to phase down, to capture some of that revenue, especially in a time when, meeting some immediate needs of individuals and also making sure that relief for businesses is targeted at the right things. This may not be the best approach, so maybe there's some savings there. In conclusion, with the recognition I'm late, New York faces some serious challenges, I recognize that, but dramatic tax increases really do have the potential to make those revenue fears self-fulfilling. And I appreciate the opportunity to speak with you today.
Thank you, Mr. Walchick, and thank you for acknowledging the time constraints here. We'll go to questions now. I have a couple of questions. I'm going to just combine them into one. Generally, I hear a consensus around, obviously, that the economy is improving, and we've recognized that in our forecasts, right? The question is improving to what and from where, I think, right? So, some would say you have no place to go but up unless you have a recurrence of the pandemic. And those are real risks. But we're recovering. But when we talk about returning to 2020 as a benchmark, that's really just getting us back to where we were potentially a year ago, right? Which from a budgeting perspective just puts us back to flat. So that's one question I have is, you know, as we return, when do we see actually real growth from the baseline? Mr. Johnson, you talked about our unemployment recovery. You know, we've seen New York City is largely dragging down the state in terms of the economic, in terms of the job recovery. If you pull out New York City, actually the rest of the state is doing better than national unemployment rates. But New York City, you can't pull out New York City, just like you can't pull out Manhattan. And those numbers are really real. We're very much behind the rest of the country. We still have about 750,000 people that are unemployed. And if you look at them, you're largely concentrated in sectors that are uniquely impacted by the pandemic. So when we talk about recovery happening earlier, even as late as the last quarter of 21, my question is, are we saying that you think those sectors are going to recover? Because we still have sectors that are largely closed and you still have people that are unemployed in those sectors. Or are we saying that those, or have we looked at, or those sectors may stay where they are, will gain jobs in other sectors that are seeing growth? Because there has been an uneven recovery as in terms of jobs and actually uneven in terms of the job losses uniquely. So the employment side is interesting to me. I think it's interesting to everyone because those are real people that are being impacted. And the belief that we will gain all of those jobs back by the end of the quarter is something that I'd like to hear a little bit more about. Also, I think, Jason, you talked about comparing it to natural disasters, right? And I think it goes into the employment discussion, it goes into the revenue discussion in terms of there's a lot of talk about there being permanent disruption in individual sectors. So unlike some of the natural disasters, the disasters are over, you know, we go back to normal. Here, we're talking, some are talking that the pandemic ends, but we don't go back to normal, right? There are permanent changes in industries, permanent changes in behavior, permanent changes with regard to retail sales and where they occur. The real estate, commercial real estate market in New York City, particularly negative impacted. I think you showed the rents dropping by 20-25%. That was on the residential side. On the commercial side, there's talk about small businesses, you know, a third of small businesses, maybe, you know, not recovering because you only have about 10% of office workers, particularly in New York City and Manhattan back there. Retail stores associated with those small businesses associated with those people working in those areas are closed. If they don't return, right, those jobs don't return and those businesses don't necessarily return. So there's the permanent, are there permanent changes, in summary, are there permanent changes to the economy that we have to pay attention to, or do we think it's just gonna go back? And on the employment side, are we talking about employment reaching that watermark level, or what happens to those other sectors that we've seen have not recovered, and those 750,000 people that are still unemployed, because it's pretty aggressive to say that those jobs are going to come back, I think, by the end of the year. And then lastly, the commercial real estate market, if that's any bellwether, right? Last recession took a very long time for that market to recover. So here again, those small businesses, they're not paying rent. You're seeing that in the commercial side. There's a lot of talk about permanent changes in relation to where people work, telecommuting, the Zoom like we're doing here, and if that has broader implications to the economy, or, you know, are we just going to, or is a sense that there's a return to normalcy like other disasters? So I think there's a lot there, but I think it all relates to the fundamental question on the recovery.
I think you mentioned my name, so maybe I should just say a thing or two. First of all, you laid out a lot of things for us to talk about and to think and to respond to. If you take a look at it's worth looking at the second quarter and the third quarter of 2020. In the second quarter, of course, we had a contraction in the New York State of economy of about 30%. And in the third quarter, we had an expansion or recovery, not of the 35% that we had the contraction, but about 30%. And the contraction was primarily driven by, as has been mentioned, the leisure and hospitality, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, arts, entertainment. Now, the contraction was pretty focused there, where you had 66% contraction in New York State in a sector which was only a 4.6% sector of the New York State economy. It accounted for approximately, depending on what you include, 25 to 40% of the contraction was in one sector, which was 4.6% of the New York State economy. That was the contraction. In the expansion, it was the same story. The expansion occurred in that sector, 4.6% of the New York State economy. That's one point that's worth keeping in mind. The second point that's worth keeping, I think, in mind is when you see a contraction in the New York State economy, it occurs primarily in the downstate MSAs or counties. The upstate economies don't contract that much. And when you see a recovery, you see the same thing. You can't have a recovery in New York State without a recovery in the New York County and all of the counties of downstate New York. And the same thing's going to happen this time. It's going to happen whether we like it or not, quite frankly. So it's going to be downstate New York that's going to lead the recovery. I said that, and when we measure it by gross state product, we'd get back to the output levels in the third quarter of this year, 2021. When measured by employment, it will be, I think I said, the third quarter of 2022. That's about right. Not the 23 that you mentioned, but 22. That's what my numbers show.
Okay.
But that's getting back to the 2019 fourth quarter. That's getting back just to where this before the pandemic started. I don't think the recovery ends there. I think it continues in 2022 and maybe 2023. I'll turn it over to Chris. Chris, when's the next recession? But the point is, it doesn't end there. I'm not saying getting back to the so-called normal, which would be 2020 levels. I'm talking about getting back to the 2019 levels and beyond. The recovery continues, and it's going to be driven by New York City or the counties in downstate New York. So that's about all I can add to what you said. I don't know if it's very helpful, but it's just kind of the way things work in New York State. And I think that's what we're faced with. We're going to recover well beyond 2022.
So that's helpful. That is helpful. Just corrected the employment return because I thought you said last quarter of 21. So it's last quarter of 22.
No, one was output, one was employment.
That's helpful. Chris, did you want to respond? You have your hand up.
I did. Yeah, I think identified some really important downside risks, and you totally nailed the employment effects and impact on local retail of the work from home associated challenges that are still with us and will continue to be with us for some time. I would add to that impacts on property values for office and retail space. The other thing on some of the jobs not coming back. When you think about travel and leisure, you think about people working in hotel, baggage handling, taxi drivers, et cetera. Travel and tourism is going to be impacted for a long time because we'll have Globally, the pandemic will be lingering. We're likely to have international travel restrictions. So tourism in New York will be depressed for quite a long time. And those jobs, you know, where do they go? What skill sets do they have that they can become reemployed elsewhere? And we do see growing sectors. We know part of what's happened is, you know, we've had this externally imposed suppression of service sector consumption. The policy response has sort of held up overall demand, not perfectly, but to some extent, while the Fed has depressed interest rates and the cost of capital has come down. So investment spending is actually doing pretty darn good. And so to the extent that New York State manufacturers can tap into that and take advantage of it, that part's good. And so you do get some compositional shift there. But I think for a lot of service sector workers, those are semi-permanent job losses that'll be with us for quite some time.
Okay, thank you. Jason?
Yeah, so I'm a little bit more optimistic about the comeback. Again, it's all very speculative. And again, it's not the Federal Reserve Bank. This is my opinion. But, you know, keep in mind that there are two effects. I'll categorize them as two effects that the pandemic has had. One, that it's disrupting activities that like people want to do. Like people want to go to Broadway shows. They want to travel. They want to eat out. But it's problematic. And then the other effect is that it has forced us, it has pulled forward, I guess, a lot of trends that were already going on. So like the trend from brick and mortar retailing to online retailing, the trend from, you know, working in the office to working at home. This isn't like a new thing. It's just that it's kind of gone into overdrive because it had to. And if you look at the period of, say, the 10 years leading up to the pandemic, or the 20 years leading up to the pandemic, when kind of these trends were going on to a much lesser degree, New York City has thrived through that period, right? So, you know, you might have thought in 2010, if someone told you, well, you know, there are going to be more people telecommuting, there are going to be more people online shopping and such, you'd say, well, New York City is probably not going to have like one of its better decades, but it has. I mean, this has been one of the strongest periods of growth in New York City. So I guess my view is that, you know, and again, a lot of it depends on the extent to which the pandemic can be brought under control. But if it is brought under control, or when it is brought under control, I think that the kind of activities that people have been wanting to do but haven't been able to do will snap back. And then things like business travel, I know that it's sort of a, it's almost like considered a sort of a stylized fact that, you know, oh, business travel isn't going to come back. I don't know. I've heard predictions about many, many things made after cataclysmic events, and, you know, they don't always come true. So I guess my view is that, you know, when things do get, quote, back to normal, I think New York City will actually be in a very, very good position because, office rents may be lower, but, you know, a lot of companies, you know, some companies are moving in, moving out of New York City. Sorry, they're, you know, lowering their office space, either moving out or reducing their footprint. But, you know, in times of an economic boom, there tend to be, you know, people like, have, you know, office space in New York City is not going to, there's not going to be no demand for it. So I think the areas that might actually be more affected are kind of the areas, you know, that people might say, oh, well, now New York City is a little more affordable. Maybe I can, and I don't need as big an office. So maybe New York City is a little bit more viable. So again, I'm not going to make a prediction. I'm not saying that, you know, that things will definitely get much, much better, that things will get back to trend. But I just have a more optimistic view of that. And then the other thing, I think it's important, what I think this underscores what Hugh was saying, and Chris, is that, you know, we're talking about getting back to pre-pandemic levels, but what you really want to do is get back to the pre-pandemic trend. So, you know, and that will obviously take longer than getting back to the levels. But I think that underscores, I think, what Q was saying, which I totally agree with, that, you know, even after we get to pre-pandemic levels, there's still going to be a lot of potential for growth, in places like New York City. And I totally agree that, you know, I hate to be so New York City centric, but I agree that New York State's outcome will be largely a function of how New York City does. So I've gone on long enough. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Let me add here,
yep.
One sector that don't minimize here, the healthcare sector, that is on a high gear. And this endemic also told us the health disparity problem, right, in a society. And so I think there'd be huge amount of activity on that front, healthcare, health disparity, and so on. A lot of employment would come from that area.
Okay, thank you. Thank you all for your answers. Those are helpful. Now I will start with Senator Liz Krueger. Senator, do you have any questions for the presenters?
I do. I appreciate all of your testimony. So a number of you talked about there could be a bigger upside than we're assuming sooner than later. So I think that is reflected by the fact that the governor just adjusted his revenue projections up $1 billion. Is that right, Rob? You increased
1.6 billion this year and 1.6 billion annually going out. So yes, 1.6 billion.
But we also know that we continue to talk about, and you all touched on it, the desperate need for federal assistance at this time. And the governor's been very clear, you know, about needing the federal money and needing it to come directly to the state and localities. But it's also true that I think the majority of the money we might be seeing out of the president's $1.9 trillion package will be not directly for the state or localities, but the money that goes into supplemental SNAP benefits for low-income people, supplemental unemployment benefits, the additional Medicaid that's coming through in a variety of ways, the additional money for education. The list is just longer and longer, apparently. I even got a call during this session here telling me, go up, go bigger. So which kinds of money generate the best longer term economic improvements for us as a state? I know we need to lobby for enough money to make sure we're not cutting our budget. I'm not undercutting you, Rob, or the governor's message here, but I'm curious whether you as economists go, you know, this kind of money coming from Washington is actually going to improve your longer term economic stability the most effectively and create new jobs in your economy that pay people. I'm curious what any of you think about that.
I could say one thing about it, and I don't know which is better, whether you have money from Washington for state and local governments to mend their problems, their deficits. But it's fairly clear to me, first of all, they're not going to get the whole $1.9 trillion.
No, I know. That was
It'll only be probably around, I think $1.5 trillion was mentioned before. And I think that's even somewhat on the optimistic side. The whole purpose of it, part of it, $1,400 for each family, is for them, as you say, snack money. But I think it's more than snack money. But let's not forget.
I meant SNAP, the Federal Nutrition Program.
Okay. Okay. But it's going to be for $1,400 for, let's just call it consumer spending. That's the demand side of the equation. Remember, the supply side of the equation is going to be a lot of small businesses, particularly arts, entertainment, lodging, obviously restaurants are going to be opening up. That's the demand, that's the supply side of the issue. The whole idea is it's not necessarily the idea, but the $1,400 in addition to the $600 from the December program is to increase spending on those companies where they're gonna start to reopen. So you ask me, is that gonna help New York State? And my answer to that question is, especially New York City, that's where there's gonna be a huge impact in New York City. And it's gonna be a huge impact, not simply from reopening all of those businesses, because I think we're gonna here I'm going to say something stupid in addition to the other stupid things I might have said, but we may get herd immunity sooner than you think. We may get that in the fall. And when we get herd immunity, the containment will be lifted. And when we get containment left and businesses reopen, you've got to hope that people go into those restaurants and spend money. And where they're going to get the money is the $1,400 in addition to the $600 that came from the December program. Is that going to help New York State and New York City? You bet it will, a lot. Now that's a little bit stupid and a little bit emphatic, but
I would say there's three things that you guys are already know. The first is invest in people, which means education and healthcare, both of those somewhat medium to longer term impact, because you have a better workforce for firms that want to come in and hire employees. Second, infrastructure. And the infrastructure in there, I would include, you know, whether it's business parks, rail connections, air travel, funding for business incubators, all the kinds of things that supports the business ecosystem, if you will. And then finally, use some of the money to lower taxes so that you're not tax disadvantaged. So those are the three big things.
If I could briefly mention something on this as well, when I look at the various federal proposals, obviously this particular $1.9 trillion package, but everything we've considered to date, to me, it seems like the greatest needs are in the areas of unemployment compensation. Obviously, states have needs, lots of different needs are out there, but this is true both on the state side and on the individual side. Obviously, the pandemic, federal unemployment compensation, that additional, it's been 600, 300, 400, the additional amount has been a lifeline for a lot of people. And how long that is available is very important, because we all hope the pandemic's lifting, but clearly we have a ways to go, and that is expiring. And that is helping keep people, people in a position to hopefully get their jobs back after the pandemic to get through until then. So it's really important from a humanitarian standpoint. It's also actually fairly good for New York State revenues, because that is taxable income as well, those unemployment compensation payments. The other side of this, though, that I don't think has gotten a lot of attention is what happens with the state trust funds and whether there's a federal role on that. New York has spent, I believe, between $14 and $15 billion in regular unemployment compensation payments since last January. That's a massive amount. States as a whole have paid about five times as much last year as they did in the previous year. Federal government's obviously provided $3 for every dollar that states have spent, but still, New York has taken out somewhere in the neighborhood of $10 billion in Title 12 advances. These will eventually need to be paid back. And to address that, you will have very significant taxes on businesses through unemployment insurance taxes. I don't know what it'll be exactly in New York. Maryland just staved off some increases where they thought that it would be a 600% increase on a business that had no layoffs during the economic contraction. And it could be up to I think 4,500% increase on businesses that were required to make substantial layoffs. This is what keeps a company from rehiring, those sort of taxes. So filling that shortfall, I mean, whether you delay those taxes, try to ameliorate them, or have some assistance to be able to do that, could be really important. When I look at the shortfalls that states have, that hole in the unemployment compensation trust fund is a huge one, because it's this liability hanging over your heads. It's going to raise taxes on precisely the worst thing, rehiring. So I would have liked to see some federal assistance there. I'd like to see states that have the capacity, if they receive more general aid, to put it towards that problem. But I think both on the relief for individual side and on the state side, that's actually one of the most important pressing questions nationwide.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Senator Krueger, do you have any other questions?
No, thank you, Rob.
Okay, thank you. We'll go to Assemblywoman Helene Weinstein.
Thank you. Just to continue, Hugh Johnson's song analogy for our economy, it almost sounds like listening to some folks that the end of next year will be singing, "We're in the money." We're in the money now with the federal stimulus. But if you look further down in those lyrics, it says, "We never see a headline about bread lines today. And when we see the landlord, we can look that guy right in the eye." Obviously, as I was mentioned before about the income inequality, the high income folks that's true for. But you know, it's on a realistic level, away from the lyrics. What does the panel think would be the best thing the state could do to spur the recovery for those who have left behind?
It might sound like slightly a bit of a trite answer, but you need to get everyone who's left to come back, or as many as possible. When you look at where the worst...
Oh, excuse me. No, when I'm saying left behind, I'm not the people who physically have, right, have left, but the people whose rent, you know, who can't pay their rent, who are on these breadlines, are going to the food pantries, are unemployed, that...
Yes, Madam Chair, and I apologize. What I meant is that the individuals who have been most affected are often in the service industries that have been substantially disrupted because of the dislocation of individuals. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of policies that the state can do to try to provide relief to these individuals, which is vitally important. You know, there's an obligation to do that, but the problems only get solved if New York is successful in getting much of the activity back into Midtown Manhattan, back into the rest of the state. So I don't think those questions can be entirely divorced from each other, you know, whether it's, you know, restaurants or lodging accommodations, you know, all of the service sectors that employ, you know, lower and lower middle income individuals who have been laid off, who are struggling to make payments. So much of that really is uniquely in New York because of this. And we don't see it at the same level in every state. I mean, every state has people struggling, but states that have such a strong concentration with a major metropolitan area like New York City are just having unique problems here because you have mass migration that does not exist elsewhere. You can't solve that problem unless you can bring most of those individuals back. And it's about more than the revenues for the state, which are important. It's just that you don't get those jobs back and you don't get that growth back for lower income individuals unless everyone else is back too.
You know, my answer will be briefer, and I would say the $1,400 from the federal government is part of the answer. The infrastructure spending, which Chris mentioned and others have mentioned, is also another part of the answer to that that question. So I hate to make it so simple, but it really is. It is that simple. And I don't know if the state has the resources now, given its fiscal position, to really chip in. The federal government has to come through with that. I mean, it isn't going to be, as I mentioned, so 1.9 trillion, but certainly a big part of that. And it's not just paychecks or checks going to individuals, it's checks going to businesses. Remember, that's a big part of what's coming out of the 1.9 trillion. It's money. It's really that simple.
If I may add one other thing, unfortunately, I don't have very New York specific, you know, information on this, but I've seen this in a lot of states. The various federal relief for individuals, some of it is checks, and that's great and that's helpful. But, you know, even if it's not one time necessarily, but it's these few staggered checks, that's not going to make rent, you know, forever. But there's a lot of relief that flows through states, whether it's the unemployment benefits, whether it's, you know, a variety of other relief that goes through social programs. And a lot of states just, this is a staggering amount, and the admin and the processing has meant that people have not received their full amount of benefits that are being paid for by the federal government just because they were denied a couple of weeks because it took too long to process or their eligibility expires. So, you know, investments the state can make, I mean, I think a lot of these happened early in the pandemic, but a lot of states are still struggling with this. Investments the state can make to make sure that every dollar that the federal government is providing to individuals is actually getting to them when administered by the state and there aren't undue delays that might actually cut off weeks of eligibility is probably vitally important and has a huge return.
Yeah, anything that can be done to encourage lending to small businesses too. I'm involved in that myself, and that really, really helps small businesses. They need money to survive. Small businesses are a big part of this problem.
But if I add, I think adding to the Medicaid expansion in state of New York is one of the quickest and the best way of really taking care of the poor. And they need healthcare, and that's where the health inequality exists, right? And also half of the money you get back from the federal government on Medicaid. So that is the all out effort, I think, on the Medicaid front that can really help. Boosting small business also. These people can then go back to work who don't have health insurance.
I just want to just throw, not to complicate things, but one of the things that I've wondered about is, like, I know in New York City, and of course, since the restaurants and retail and like street level establishments have, you know, these are the businesses that have been the most affected. I've heard, so I don't know the tax, and maybe, I don't know, Jared, maybe you know the answer to this, but I think that the way property, commercial property is taxed, makes it dependent on like rental income as opposed to based on the value of the property. And if that's the case, then that, you know, what you're doing is basically providing a bit of a tax offset to keeping properties vacant. And, you know, to me, I've just, this is very anecdotal, but I, over the last, you know, always, but certainly over the last few years, I've seen an awful lot of vacancies, retail vacancies in New York City that seem to linger on for longer than you would imagine they would. And I don't know if there's, if that's, you know, a function of the tax code or what, but I just, I don't know if anyone has an answer to that. It's more of a question than a state.
I think I can slightly speak to that. I believe that the income method is more about income capacity than it is about precise income at a point in time. It would adjust with the economy, but I don't know that it would necessarily go down because they haven't filled a vacancy.
Thank you all.
Yes. Chairwoman, are you done? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Chair. We will go to Senator O'Mara. Do you have any questions?
Hopefully briefly, but in regards to the stimulus money that's out there and expected, how much of any of the rebound that we've seen in the economy been not directly related to that stimulus money that's been put out there? And what concerns do you have in the long term or the significantly growing national debt that's out there? You know, we talk in New York that we don't want to borrow money in New York because we don't want our kids and grandkids to pay for it. But we seemingly have no problem asking Uncle Sam to do that and have the whole country's kids and grandkids pay for it. So I guess anything in the growth related, unrelated to the stimulus at this point, and what's the overall impact of this growing debt for our long term?
A good part of the snapback is not related to stimulus. It's just sort of the activity that's being more or less the light switch has been turned back on. Also, as I noted, there's been this sort of switch in the mix of GDP. We had externally imposed decline in service sector consumption, and investment spending has come back strong. Some of that has been, for example, in high tech, with the onset of the pandemic and the expansion of work from home, computer sales were off the charts. So that sector, you know, just responded. That's just peculiar to this particular recession. I expect that, the stimulus has a lot to do with that. I mean, we saw it's the first recession ever where personal income went up instead of declining. So, you know, stimulus played a very big role there. I think, and stimulus will continue this year, probably account for, you know, a half to two thirds of whatever growth we see. And then as we get into 2022, we'll be on the backside of the stimulus. There'll be a bit of a payback. So we'll probably drop below what will become the post-pandemic trend growth rate for a year or two. And then we'll get back to that sort of post-pandemic trend. And with respect to debt, I mean, you raise a very good question. The profession is certainly, its views have moved on this. That with the global economy being awash with excess saving and very low interest rates globally, where the interest rates are more or less below the growth rate, that the burden of the debt and the ability to service that debt is such that we can probably borrow a lot right now to deal with the current problem. And once we get past it, then the dynamics are such that we can invest in infrastructure that should have rates of return that are well in excess of the cost of borrowing. So the views have really changed. Will the chickens come home to roost at some point? We can't take our eye off of that. I think we have to, you know, always be concerned about that. And somewhere out there, you know, we can't completely toss fiscal austerity in the trash can.
But if I may add, during the last, you know, recession, a lot of money was spent, not this much as this time. People have studied that for $1 spending, how much was the return, okay? Typically in the average, you don't get a rate of return. $1, you get $1 back. There are two sectors where there's a huge return was education, school education, and transportation. That is where, like, you spend $1, you get $2. Others were washed, really, you know, when you get the money to. So to answer your question, I worry when the help goes untargeted. It does worry me. The help should go, it should be more targeted rather than a flat out money to people who don't really don't need it.
Yeah, and on that, sir, the you know, we use terms like the stimulus payments, but in some ways, I think that's a misnomer. Certainly, it did increase personal income, and we see some effects on consumption short term. So, yeah, is there some really short term stimulus? Yes. Is it really doing something to stimulate the economy in a meaningful way? Probably not. And that doesn't mean it's bad, because meeting immediate needs is clearly important. I mean, I think that seeing these as, you know, economic payments to help people pay the bills is probably a better outlook than thinking of them about as a way to stimulate the economy. And that can help you decide the size and how you target them and all kinds of things Congress needs to do. But I don't really see the payments that have been made thus far as being meaningful economic stimulus.
It's a recovery. It's not stimulus, really. Go to the food bank and see what kind of recovery you are talking about, right? That's a fact. Food lines, look at that, right? That is where the help is needed, I think. Not across the board, send a check, $1,400 to everybody. I don't need the money, right? Possibly you don't need the money. But some people do. And that should be targeted.
Yeah, I would just push back on that very vigorously. It has been stimulus, you know. GDP was down 2.5% last year. It could have been down 4.5-5% without the stimulus that we saw. And this year, the upturn is certainly going to be enhanced by $3 trillion of additional stimulus that we got at the end of last year and this year. So, you know, if you think a couple of percentage points of extra GDP growth, which, you know, translates into millions of jobs being restored sooner than otherwise, if you think that's not meaningful, well, that's your definition. But I think the numbers bear out that the stimulus will have considerable impact, certainly on economic growth and employment.
Thank you. Senator, do you have any other questions?
If I could just ask one briefly, Robert, sorry, I know we've been here a long time, but there is a proposal in the budget to forego a middle-class tax cut valued at about $400 million. Yet there's a proposal in there as well to continue the Hollywood tax credit, film credit, for a little over $400 million, which would be more important in stimulating our economy of those two proposals.
I have a pretty strong view on that. I don't believe that the film tax credits are generating much. Massachusetts studied this. They said that they got 6 cents on every dollar they spent. Connecticut, I think, said 7 cents. Some states have looked at how long a job that's created lasts, and Michigan looked and said 23 days. These are not things that are making a really significant impact on your economy. It's not something that I would prioritize probably any time, but let alone right now. Now, if we're talking about where the economic impact is, the middle income tax reductions, I think, they're great. There's a commitment that's been made to lower those rates. Is that where all of the investment decisions are going to be made on the margin? I don't know that that's the case. Is it good economically compared to the status quo? Clearly. Will people appreciate those lower rates? I'm sure they will. You know, if those are my two choices, I would certainly think that the film tax credit is a way lower priority.
Anyone else on that?
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you, Senator. Assemblyman Ra, do you have any questions?
Yes, thank you. Thank you all. This has been a really great discussion. I just have a couple of questions and then one last piece about unemployment, but a couple of questions regarding, I had spoke earlier about out-migration and the tax climate. And so I'm just going to lay out a couple of pieces if you want to weigh in on it. Jared really did speak about a lot of this in his presentation, but I'd be interested in the other panelists. Just in terms of, you know, we're some of the tax proposals that are out there from different members of the legislature, you know, are targeting individuals, businesses. So is there a concern that that will cause out migration? What is the long-term impact then on our economy, on our tax base? And if you have any thoughts on the idea that some of these maybe are more appropriately left to the federal level as opposed to the state level, so as to not create, you know, disadvantages for New York, and then also how this change in circumstances, people being used to working from home, and, you know, the potential that major businesses may maybe, you know, in New York City, maybe lower their office footprint there as we go forward. So how does that impact our long-term tax receipts? Obviously, Mr. Johnson, and I think the others kind of concurred that our recovery is going to be driven largely by New York City and downstate. So if you have thoughts on those topics.
Anyone have anyone want to respond to that?
A lot of our business, we have a family office business, and it focuses on providing all sorts of services, tax services, doing taxation returns for some fairly wealthy people. And the only thing I can tell you is that the question about whether they should continue to be domiciled in New York State comes up every time.
I already presented on this. I didn't want to take too much time on this, but I would say that, you know, taxes have always been one of the things that individuals and businesses use when they decide location decisions. But it's one of many things. They care about the overall cost of business, the cost of living. They care about the climate. They care about amenities, all kinds of things. But like I said, we've got this disaggregation right now. It is easier to have an a la carte selection of what you want and what you don't want. So things that may have been difficult to select on in the past, like tax burdens, are suddenly easier to. Not everyone will care. And, you know, there are a lot of people who will say that, you know, what New York City and what New York State has to offer is well worth it. But there will absolutely be people and businesses on the margin that will make those decisions even based on current tax rates and proposals of significantly higher ones, especially those that may target, you know, some of the industries that have a huge agglomeration effect in the state, you know, like the financial services industry and the financial sector could have really significant location decisions. I think that every major metro area is going to probably suffer a little with this problem, but New York has the potential to do so more than most.
Okay, thank you.
And then,
any more?
Yeah, just one other thing. You know, we talked about obviously the, you know, things like the unemployment benefits and when we can, you know, get back to, you know, some level of full employment. But we know there's been needs out there throughout this pandemic. The enhanced federal unemployment benefits, you know, were needed and continue to be needed in many instances. But you know, as this gets extended, if it does out, is there going to be a point that there needs to be some incentive for some individuals to return to the workforce to get us to closer to full employment?
Well, I'll just chime in briefly on that because I mentioned earlier, we do monthly business surveys and we get comments. And that's a comment that we hear from businesses quite a bit, that that they're really having trouble finding and retaining people because of the unemployment benefits being generous, and they have to compete with that. And it's not just that people are, you know, they're kind of lazy and they'd rather just, you know, sit around. The fact is a lot of them have, you know, children, they have other needs, they may have, you know, be vulnerable we're all vulnerable, but they may be particularly vulnerable, or they may have someone in their family. So there are a lot of reasons that on top of the incentives created by the unemployment insurance that are sort of keeping people out of the workforce. And, you know, but that's what you hear from businesses. At the same time, though, you know, you hear a lot of stories from people who can't find jobs, who like really want jobs. And so I think it's a good question, but when you ask, is this likely to become a problem? I think it is an area of concern for small businesses. And so, I'll just leave it there, because I don't have strong opinions on these kind of policies.
There was a very nice piece by Michael Strain at the American Enterprise Institute suggesting that there be a reemployment bonus that be paid to the unemployed person when they go back and take a job, which is a really interesting idea. It might be something like a supplement to an earned income tax credit kind of notion.
Yeah, the only other thing I would mention is that Germany has struggled with this issue for a long time, and it might be worth taking a look at what's going on there.
I just want to add that Michael Strain used to be at the New York Fed. And I worked with him. He's a very smart guy.
But in terms of inducing people to go back, I think the minimum wage can help, actually. You know, get if they get a little bit more money.
Great. Well, thank you all.
Okay. Well, thank you, everyone. We've been going at this for 3 hours, but I think it actually has been a very informative discussion, and it will be very helpful as we craft not only the budget, but actually it will help us reach a consensus revenue forecast. I know these are very challenging times, as you have all highlighted, and we'll have to navigate the uncertainty ahead, because we don't really know what awaits, but being informed is critical. So I want to thank our presenters again, Mr. Varvaris, Mr. Johnson, Mr. Bram, Mr. Lahiri, and Mr. Walchek. Thank you very much for participating, and to the entire panel as well. Thank you to Chair Krueger, Chair Weinstein, Senator Tom O'Mara, Assemblyman Ra, and Maria Dulles from the Comptroller's Office. Thank you very much. And unless there's any objection, this will conclude the Revenue Forecasting Conference for 2021. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you all for keeping. Thank you all.